Please welcome your host, Matt Andrews. Welcome to the UK's biggest gaming festival, Insomnia 55, where thousands of gamers have travelled from all over the world to take part in our 24-hour LANs, explore our exhibition hall, see developer playthroughs and early previews of new games, and to play in our many esports tournaments as well. And here in our esports arena, it is time for the Emerge Dota 2 Cup! Thanks to LG and Multiplay for our esports arena. Two teams from some of the best in UK and Europe who are playing for a share of our £5,000 prize pool. Thanks to our sponsors, Emerge, who sponsor all of our Dota 2 tournaments throughout 2015, including at I-56, our newly announced tournaments and newly announced LANs from the 11th to the 14th of December this year. Our two finalists met earlier in this tournament, so we're expecting a great rematch. And our first team are Monkey, who had a fairly straightforward route through to the final. They're a team with some previous LAN winners on it, and only one team managed to take a map off of them all the way through. And the team who managed to take one map from them are their opponents here in the final, who are Zenix. Again, a very, very experienced team, dropped down to the lower bracket and had to beat the number one seed to make it through here to our final. Please welcome our finalists in the Emerge Dota 2 Cup, Monkey and Zenix. So it's Monkey versus Zenix in a rematch, a grudge match, a match taking part for our final for a share of our £5,000 prize pool. We'll see if it turned out like it did earlier on in the tournament. Of course, Monkey start with a one game advantage in our best of five. And to take you through the action here in our final, it's over to ODPixel and WakeyPixel.
Indeed, hello ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the casting desk here for myself, ODPixel, and as Matt said, Wakey, we're ready to get ourselves into this first game, best of five of course, and worth noting as well, so Rhyme's team, aka Team Monkey, they're going in with a one game advantage because they're coming from the upper bracket.
They are indeed, and they've been brilliant so far this tournament as well. I mean, they've breezed through, very little difficulty, and the one difficulty they did have is of course against the team they're now facing in the final, which is Zenix, and that Warlock pick in the second game is the one that really screwed them over. So hopefully we'll be maybe seeing a bit of a niche pick coming out again, because we were very excited when we saw that one.
We've seen a few kind of funky things coming out from the side of Zenix. They also played the Slada.
They did.
Yeah, which I'd love to see again. And not something that we see a lot of the time in competitive Dota. But in the UK scene, you know, you never really kind of know what to not expect, and they'll always, the players like to throw things in that the people from outside of the world of the UK Dota probably will think, hang on, is that really the pick?
It's definitely one of the characteristics of UK Dota. You do get those, as you said, funky picks. And the Slada was an interesting one in the game that we saw them get into this final in the first place.
Yeah.
And that was actually against the Lushrak. They let the Lushrak through, they didn't ban it in that first stage, and then they picked the Slada to help deal with it. Got an early BKB, early Blink Dagger, and it was just really great to watch them see them just mantle this hero that's just been absolutely destroying the meta recently.
And especially against a player who, as you said from your research, was a Lesh spammer. So this Lesh spammer got his backside handed to him on a plate because of this Slada. So it's very entertaining to watch. And I'm hoping we see some more Slada, potentially some more Warlock. I think that might be more on the cards for the side of Zenix, because we've seen them do it a few times this tournament. And it's a strong pick. Ishigo knows what he's doing with a hero.
He really does, yeah. I mean, it's just a tanky hero in the mid lane. It's very, very difficult to bring down. And if you decide to dive onto it with more than one hero, as soon as he hits level 6, there's that option of the turnaround. The TP's come in, the rock gets dropped, and you can all of a sudden find yourself losing two or three heroes in the space of a few seconds.
And here we go anyway, right into the draft here of this first game on the main esports stage. And the band so far, pretty much what we expect. Lina and Lesherak, nothing too out of the ordinary there. We know that Rhyme likes to play his Lina, and we know he's pretty darn good at it. We've seen him pick it up a few times. I want to say, I think he lost one of the games where he did have the Lina.
No, he lost against the Lina.
He lost against the Lina.
Yeah, we saw the return matchup, if you like, because he played the Lina against the SF, absolutely dominated the laning stage. In fact, that was in the upper bracket final, I believe, to get here. Mm-hmm. Against the number one seed. They played in that first first game. He played the Lina. They absolutely crushed all of the lanes, and it was probably one of the most one-sided games we've seen in the tournament. And it's no surprise that ZenX are going to ban that out in the first stage.
Yeah, and I really like this ban here as well. Second ban, the Darkseer. Of course, the side of Monkey, they have got Corey. I was talking to the side earlier, and they did kind of admit that they do like to pick up the Darkseer if it's left in the pool. They'll take it pretty much every time, and we know why, because we've seen games where teams have let them, and Corey, he's an absolute beast on the Darkseer.
Yeah, he's just absolutely incredible. I mean, we've seen him get solo kills on that off lane, and once you've got an off lane hero that not only dies, not only is able to find farm in the lane, but he's also able to find kills as well, it just is another added threat that's in your arsenal that you can just provide constantly. And banning it out, I think absolutely the right decision from ZenX. Of course, that is going to leave a few heroes in the pool that you would possibly see out, and we're going to see one of them coming out straight away in the Tusk, and the other one in the Bounty Hunter as well, respectively going on opposite teams.
Yeah, we know that ZenX, they like to put a lot of priority on both the Bounty Hunter and the Wyvern. We've seen them pick it at those two heroes being picked up first by them, and of course vice versa. You take away one of them from them, and they're understandably going to go for the one that's left in. So Bounty Hunter's there. The Tusk Dazzle combo, though, coming straight out from the side of Monkey. We know how strong that is with the heal bomb potential, depending on who they want to line it up with. And ZenX here, they're going to be able to get themselves the Queen of Pain through the draft. And of course, one of those heroes, there's a lot of versatility, a few positions that is it ZenX who have played it in different ones?
We've seen it played everywhere, actually. I mean, we've seen we actually saw Monkey play it in the safe lane. We've seen it played, obviously, in its traditional mid lane, but we've also seen it played a lot in the off lane as well.
Yeah.
So the fact that they can just pick this one up, we imagine potentially the mid hero, but it's a hero that you can adapt the draft to if you need to in the later stages if there's something that gets thrown up that you weren't quite expecting. And I think that's just why it's such a nice pick to be able to pick up this early on. Dazzle, of course, being picked up by Monkey, we know how much they love this hero. In fact, two of the heroes we've seen throughout the most of this tournament have been the Winter Wyvern and the Dazzle, just these defensive supports that have just been so, so strong. Obviously, the Wyvern being banned out by Monkey, they pick the Dazzles up for themselves, and I think they'll be very, very happy with that one.
Yeah, indeed. The ban's now coming up on this second round. We've got rid of the Anti-Mage here. ZenX banning that. And Monkey, they take away the Shaker from ZenX. And I like this. When you're running something like a Tusk, you know, it's the Snowball, fantastic tool for initiating, but it's also something that can be turned on its head. And if you're playing up against a Shaker who's going to be able to capitalize on your heroes grouping up and throwing themselves into the center of the fight, you just want to be really careful about the Shaker and also the AA as well. These huge AoE combos that can kind of turn the Snowball on its head. Monkey's just taking that straight out of the pool.
You're absolutely right. I mean, we've seen already so far this tournament, Tusk is such a high-reward, high-risk hero, and we've seen it backfire as well a couple of times, not only with the Snowball, but also with the Ice Shards as well. You have to be so careful of that positioning. And I think we've seen a couple of ganks in the mid lane this tournament so far with Tusk. The Ice Shards have actually blocked off his own mid laner from the retreat, and they've been picked off. So,
yes,
very, very nice hero. And, well, Phantom Lance is going to be picked up. A hero that actually ZenX, they do favour. In fact, they did quote it as the strongest carry in the game at the moment.
They also did quote, say that Ember Spirit was the way you deal with it.
Yes.
And they get it. So I think, one half of them is going to be a bit kind of, they got the PL, but at the same time, they're going to be happy that Ember was still in the pool and they've managed to snag it up here. And of course, as well, Ember, one of those heroes, in like the Earthshake and the AA, in the sense that you can turn that Snowball on its head. If you've got a Battle Fury online, that's a lot of heroes that are going to take a lot of cleave damage.
Yeah, definitely. And it's interesting, actually, that if they were going to pick the Phantom Lancer, Team Monkey, they didn't actually ban out the Ember Spirit. They instead favoured, like you mentioned, the Earthshaker because of the Tusk reasons that you mentioned, and also the AA as well, which is obviously very, very strong against the Dazzle. Shallow Grave was only going to delay the inevitable rather than providing these, you know, clutch game-saving saves. And instead, the Ember Spirit gets through, and ZenX pick it straight up, as you say, knowing that it is their particular counter to the Phantom Lancer.
They obviously, with the Ember Spirit, Monkey realizing they need a little bit more control of the battlefield, they grab themselves the Disruptor, which, if played correctly, which I'm sure it will be, because we've seen some fantastic Disruptor displays from the side of Monkey in this tournament. Toto, I can't remember, was it in the upper bracket final? Went 0-0-20.
0-0-20. Yeah, absolutely flawless support play. And he's just such an impressive player on the hero. And like you say, against the Ember Spirit, it's going to be very, very nice getting the vision with the Thunderstrike, and then also into the Kinetic Field Static Storm combo. He's not going to be able to do anything at all. So, yeah, very, very strong pick for them, I think.
Final two picks now coming up from both sides. The TA has been banned out by ZenX. We've seen Rhyme play that before this tournament, and it's against the Ember Spirit in the mid lane. Rhyme just plays the hero so well. Of course, there's already that edge in the sense that you just deal with the fact that Refraction isn't going to be that great in lane against an Ember by focusing your other skills. You max out the Meld, you max out the Psyblades, and suddenly Anytime Ember tries to commit and go in with the Flame Guard, you just smack him right in the face with a huge amount of physical damage and armor reduction. And Ember Spirit, he has to hope that he's got a way of getting himself back out, because if you've got a rotation coming in from a Tusk or someone that's going to be able to control him in the mid, Ember Spirit is just going to die fairly easy.
Yeah, he is one of those squishy heroes, and it's like you say, it's not like he has that innately low armor to start with, and it's not like he's a hero that builds up stat items. He tends to go for those Battle Furies, those Deadlesses, those crits, and it just doesn't provide you, you know, if you do get caught out by a lot of physical damage, then you can be in a hell of a lot of trouble. And while talking of physical damage, we've got a Shadow Fiend now on the pool, so that we imagine is going to be their mid hero for the side of Monkey. And I mean, well, talk about the rhyme Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of his signature heroes, and I like it against the Ember. Shadow Fiend, he's got the magical damage, and he's got the physical damage. So Flame Guard, a couple of raises, your Flame Guard's gone, and he can get there in there with the punches. So both ways, it's going to be very nice, I feel, in the mid lane against the Ember. But of course, we're going to know Ishigo, the captain of Zenix, a very, very skilled player, and not necessarily going to be an easy time for Rhyme in the mid, as I'm sure Ishigo's going to try and give him a run for
I think money. What's nice as well about the Shadow Fiend, and especially Rhyme playing it, is he tends to maximize his efficiency in terms of his jungle stacks as well. And at the sort of time that we're looking for the Ember Spirit to come online with massive amounts of magical damage, where he might be able to pick off the low HP Shadow Fiend, he's not going to be in the lane constantly. He's going to be pushing it out with the raises, rotating in and out of the lane and the jungle. And it's just going to be actually really difficult to be able to find that opening to actually pick the Shadow Fiend off. So I think it's a really, really nice fifth pick.
Absolutely. Being on the Radiant side, you've got that ability to get those stacks up. And that's one thing a lot of the other UK players have said about this team. They stack. Their efficiency is absolutely off the charts. And I'm sure Zenix would try and do something against that. They do, of course, have the Bounty Hunter, a very good hero for scouting this out. And they've got the Quap and they've got the Gyro. So if the rotations come through, they do have the potential to clean up the stacks themselves and take them away from Monkey.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm sure that's what their lineup is. There's a little bit of that in there as well. The fact that if they do find those stacks with the Bounty Hunter, they have heroes that can come in and take advantage of it.
Final pick now for Zenix. We are still looking for their final support hero here. I mean, it's a very kind of aggressive and greedy lineup in a sense with the Quap Ember Gyro Tricore. And with a Bounty Roaming as well.
I mean, you've got probably, a Bounty Roaming, so you're probably looking for a support that is going to be able to stay in the lane, a support that is going to be able to support the Gyro. We know that the Rubick is still in the field, actually,
Rubick,
which obviously works very, very nicely with the Gyrocopter in lane. And there's decent spells to steal on the map as well, of course. I mean, we've got the Shallow Grave coming in from Dazzle, obviously. Disruptor, Glimpse, an amazing spell to steal if you can get it. Static Storm as well, obviously. Most of the ultimates out here.
Rubick
would be a very, very nice pick, but they're going to go for the Witch Doctor instead.
Okay, understandable as well, because what I do like with the Gyro, the Ember, and the Quap, and the Bounty, they're going to look to fight. They're going to look for pickoffs, and they're going to look to push and put on the aggression. And if you can have someone like a Witch Doctor that's going to allow you to have that extra sustainability when you look for these earlier skirmishes, it's going to be a very powerful asset for the side of Zenix.
Yeah, definitely. I really like both lineups. It's going to be interesting. Early game is going to be very, very important. If the Shadow Fiend can get a good start in the mid lane, I think it's going to be very, very difficult to stop him. Like we've mentioned, just because of the efficiency of this team, Monkey, they do so many stacks constantly throughout the entire game. And they're in there as the higher seed, and they are the favourites.
Which is understandable as well. And it's got to be scary for Zenix, because they're playing up against Beezer, someone that's tipped to be the best carry in the UK, and understandably so in terms of what he's been picked up for recently, joining Bone 7 Forces for his new team. And he's on PL, or as you were saying, one of the carries that Zenix has said is probably the best carry in the game. So
So you have one of the best players that are here at this tournament on one of the arguably best carries in the game at the moment.
Yeah.
It's a scary place to be, but like you say, they've got the Ember Spirit to try and deal with it, and that's going to be up to Ichigo, we imagine, who's taking that towards the mid lane to see whether he can do that against Rhyme Shadow Fiend.
As you said, if he's going to be playing anything that he's going to be happy about against it, it is going to be the Ember Spirit. But I'm just really interested to see how much Whelp can achieve on this Bounty Hunter, because as I said, with the Quap, the Gyro, and the Ember, if they're able to be, you know, globally aggressive, which we will probably expect to see once like the Gyro gets the 6 online, I'm hoping we kind of see some kind of C-deck aggressive style Gyrocopter where he turns up to the fights and he turns up to the right ones and he can capitalize on the kind of the overextension of Monkey, find those early kills, and with the track gold, they do have the potential to spiral out of control.
It was something that C-deck were just so good at TI, just face rushing the opposition and aggressive on that Gyrocopter, on the PL that he liked to play as well. I mean, there was a Gyrocopter in some of the games where he was like turning up in the mid lane 6 minutes into the game,
exactly.
And it's like a roaming support,
and
you just don't expect it. So, I mean, Watson's Water obviously has a very, very good, link with Ichigo as well. Hopefully they'll be able to maybe come up with some little strategies early on in the game that's going to maximise their efficiency.
Indeed, I do apologise. We just got to pause at the moment. Looks like potentially technical issues or something. We're just waiting for the teams to ready themselves up so we can get into this game, but. I think as we were kind of hyping up, this is going to be a good match. It's, as you said, in a higher seed it is Monkey. But Zenix obviously going into this one feeling very confident. They have played a series already today, working their way through the lower bracket final. And as we've said, taking out the top seed. I mean, you're going to be on a
bit
of a high.
That is one of the things that we have to mention, of course. Monkeys haven't played yet today.
No, they haven't played.
They haven't played a game today. They got into the grand final yesterday. Zenix, of course, had to play this morning, work their way up against the number one seed, as you said. Will give them confidence, give them momentum coming into this game. And that might be exactly what they need. I mean, these two teams are going to be very, very closely matched. So just being able to have that little bit of an advantage going in might make all the difference.
And here we go, ladies and gentlemen, as the game does begin to get underway. And straight away, of course, Corey actually heading up here with the TP. He's going to be looking for some early warding action. And oh, Moot. He's going to be able to get himself a ward down in lane, but he's going to get, vision of each other here. So they know what's up. Moot's going to be able to deal with that ward potentially. Now he knows that Corey's made that early movement here into the dire jungle. And well, what are we seeing in terms of lanes? Pretty much what we expect here from the side. It is, of course, going to be Tsoodle playing that off lane quap. And then on the rest of the side is Zenix. It will be well roaming around on the Bounty Hunter. It should go on that mid lane Ember Spirit. Watson's water on his position, one Gyro, and Moot playing this Witch Doctor. I'm OD Pixel, of course, I'm joined by Wakey Pixel here for game one. Wakey, what are we seeing from the side of Monkey? Is it, again, pretty much what we expected in terms of lanes?
Yeah, pretty much what we expected. It looks like it is going to be this defensive tri-lane. Cookie's going to be playing on the Dazzle. He's going to be down here, obviously, supporting the PL, which is going to be played by Beezer, Toto, on his Disruptor, which we've already seen has been very impressive so far in this tournament. Rhyme, they're going to be able to secure the bottom room, which is something that they tend to do, actually. I've always, I think most of the games we've casted them in this tournament, they tend to go for this bottom room to secure it for the mid laner, and that's exactly what they're going to do this time around. Obviously, the trading comes. Ichigo is going to be able to secure the top rune on the Ember Spirit as well, so fairly even trades in terms of the runes at the start of the game, and we'll be able to get ourselves into this
well got
stage.
It though. Zenix get both the runes as Welp is able to get it and take it away from Rhyme straight under his nose. So very nicely done there by the side of Zenix, and they're going to be happy with that kind of start. Of course, we're finally noting we have Corey on this offlane Tusk, who, well, already is up to a very nice bit of shenanigans here, getting that creep pull off and block off to the side. So it's going to make it a little bit easier to start lane mid lane. There's a lot of hate being focused on Rhyme as we've got three heroes at the moment looking towards the SF. He does have this ward down, so he knows what's up. Well, it's going to come in, and well, the D ward straight away there, the double tango. Just going to trade a few hits here. No one's going to go down, and we'll see Moot probably focus his attention elsewhere, as maybe a go on Rhyme at this point isn't going to be the best move.
Yeah, no, I mean, this is just a really nice thing to do, just to be able to support Ichigo in the lane at the start, make sure Rhyme doesn't get a good start and start to snowball with those extra souls stacked up, because it is so difficult for a Shadow Fiend to lane in the early stages of the game. And if you can just delay that a little bit with just a little bit of extra support for the first minute or two, then yeah, that can be so beneficial, and it can help Ichigo just secure the lane for himself.
Welp just coming in to disrupt the pool here. They do have sentries down though on the side of Monkey, so they will know what he's up to. Toto will get a whiff of him there. Back on the bottom lane, Cook just trying to harass back Tsoodle, creating that space here for Beezer. So far has been all right. Mid lane, 5-for-5, 3-for-1. Ichigo, thanks to that bit of a help from his supports at the start, has got that slight edge. But as you said, once Ryan gets the momentum, gets those souls up, and gets a couple of points into raises, and whoa, okay, Corey gets himself first blood on the off lane. Nearly missed that one, but didn't expect the Tusk there to be able to get a solo kill in a lane where there's a Jar and a Witch Doctor.
Well, we talked about it in the draft, and we talked about how competent he is on the Darkseer, and, well, this time showing off his Tusk, being able to find a solo kill in the lane, so important for Corey, and he's already managed to crack level 3 before the 2-minute mark, and this offlane is going very, very nicely for Monkey so far.
Yeah, and I mean, we've seen the kind of plays in a lot of the games from the side of Monkey where he picks up the Darkseer. As you said, if he gets a good start on the Tusk, I wouldn't be surprised if we see more insane action here from the map. He's going to be right here. It's just a level 1 Maledict ticking him down. But nonetheless, being a Rastback, he has got a salve on him, so we'll be able to remain in lane. And it'll be interesting to see how much Tsoodle can get done on this offlane quad, which, as we say, I'm pretty sure it was Tsoodle before who played the offlane queen.
I think we've seen him play it a couple of times. They've run it in dual lanes a couple of times as well, with combination of other heroes. They did an aggressive tri-lane, I think, actually against Monkeys with the Undying at one point, so he's very used to playing it in this lane. He should be okay up against Beezer's PL. He has obviously got the Dazzle backing him up if he gets into any trouble, but I don't think Queen of Pain will be able to find any solo kills. Just wants to suck up the XP as much as possible and then look to try and make ganks happen once she hits level 6 along with the Bounty Hunter.
Yeah, indeed. No, it's interesting.
Talking off Bounty Hunter mid lane, looks like Rhyme might be
in trouble.
Okay.
Flame
Guard's going to be enough damage.
That's a kill in return there. Zenix getting themselves on the board. Ember Spirit killing Rhyme. Pretty big play there for himself. top lane. Oh, Corey just going back in on it. And 1-1 at the moment between these two sides. And as you said, bringing down Rhyme at this point, especially in a lane where he's already losing out in terms of CS. 13-5 on Ishigo compared to the 9-3. But as we were saying earlier, it's all about the efficiency from the side of Monkey. If they can get those stacks up in the jungle, Rhyme will be able to catch back up. But I think Ishigo's going to be very happy with how this lane started out.
Yeah, it's very, very nice. And I mean, Whelp's actually not doing too bad in terms of levels as well. He's cracked level 3, he's hanging around here. He is sucking a little bit of XP away from Ichigo, but it doesn't really matter because they're finding the kills and they're going to go for it again.
The dive comes in. If they can get in, it's not quite enough damage. Rhyme would just turn around with the punches and force Ishigo back. But yeah, the side of Zenix really trying to force the issue there on the mid lane and do what they can to shut Rhyme down early on, which is exactly what you need to do when going up against an SF.
Yeah, they're really utilising the Bounty Hunter well in this early game just to try and shut them down that SF, as you say. And well, now Bounty Hunter's heading towards the top lane, maybe looking to see if they can go aggressive onto Corey. He does have the Snowball, of course, and the Ice Shard. He's actually level 4, so he's doing very, very nicely still in this off lane. And it is difficult for a Witch Doctor to be able to harass him out, especially because Corey just has, you know, decently high armor at the start of the game.
And the help pull as well, and end with the bottle. He's going to be okay bottom lane. Soodle just trading hits with Beeza. Worth noting in terms of both Beeza and Watson's Warder, 24-15 on the Jara at the moment compared to 20-9. So slight edge over the PL. But of course, we can expect PL to get to that point where he's going to be able to flash it. But at the same time, Jara can obviously keep his farm game up very, very nicely. Cooks actually comes to the mid lane with this Invis Rune, potentially seeing if he can set something up onto Ishigo. Still yet to hit level 6, hasn't got those remnants available, so it would be a good time if they can catch him out. But it looks like with this next creep wave coming in, he should be able to get the remnants online before Monkey can make a jump on him.
Yeah, it's going to be very, very close. Cookie's definitely hanging around. They know that he's going to be hitting level 6 reasonably soon, and instead it's just going to be a little harassed with the heal. Not really achieving too much in the lane. And
they're going to just leave that one for the time being. Corey, reaching onto level 5. Jara, nearly got his 6 online here. And Will's just going back down to the bottom lane now. His global presence has been fantastic, up and down the entirety of the map. Just trying to find out where he's best suited at the moment. And just doing what he can to disrupt that pull and ensure that, of course, his offlaner, Soodle, gets as much as he can from the lane.
One thing we should mention now as well is Whelp on this Bounty Hunter, he has started to slow down a little bit. They've not been finding kills recently and he's not been involved in too much. And obviously, because it's a roaming Bounty Hunter, you don't have a lane where you can just, you know, jump into and sap XP that isn't going to hurt the rest of your team. He's still only level 3 and he's starting to slow down a bit. He wants to get that level 6 online as quickly as possible, and if he manages to find it sort of around about 11 minutes, that would be very, very nice for the team. But at the moment, he's not really on course to do that.
He's just checking out the jungle now as well. Stacks are starting to be made here by Cook, preparing them for Rhyme on the SF so Rhyme can keep his game up. And what we see in terms of CS now, Rhyme's actually managed to overtake Ishigo by quite a bit in terms of the last hits. 39-6 against the 27-7. So Rhyme, as we said, even though he fell behind early on, SF being SF, he's had that potential to just really catch up and put Ishigo back in his place. Bottom lane though, Beeza having a grand old time. And so's the Jara. I mean, this is going to be kind of the thing in this game. The Jara and the PL, who can kind of come out on top in terms of when these carries go head to head. But we've got to remember that Zenix, if they do get a decent timing on the Battle Fury on Ishigo, they're going to feel fairly confident in terms of getting a fight started. Well, moving in on the bottom lane, we've got Ishigo rotating in as well. Maybe seeing if they can do anything about Beeza here. They move forward with the Flame Guard. There's going to be a TP reaction coming in though from Dazzle. Actually going to be cancelled here. But nonetheless, Disruptor will be able to force back the issue that was being pushed by Zenix. And no one's going to go down here quite yet on the bottom lane.
Yeah, it's an interesting pick actually, the Gyrocopter, because we talked to Zenix before the game and they talked about obviously the power of the PL, how they think that the Ember Spirit counters it. They actually didn't think the Gyro was that good against the PL in the later stages of the game. So they probably are relying a lot more on the Ember Spirit to have a good early game and get some decent items up at a decent timing. But at the moment, Watson's Water, I mean, he's farming away very, very nicely as well. And do you think they'll be very, very active? We've seen a lot of Gyrocopters that, like we mentioned about C-Deck, that are very, very active in the early game, as Corey actually throwing out the Walrus Punch on the top lane. There's going to be the cooldown coming in from Watson's Water. He's got the Rocky Barrage as well, but the Snowball in comes to dodge it. And now he's actually just going to be a right-click battle, but it looks like Watson's Water might be winning this one, and he's going to be able to get the Rocky Barrage as well, and down goes Corey on the off lane.
Is it a bit of a BM pause here by the looks of it? I mean, we do have a pause here from Zenix, but yeah, as you said, Water's Water managing to come out on top of that, and it looked a little bit risky, you know, when the Snowball came out and Corey was able to duke out some of the damage from the cooldown. But yeah, coming out on top. The TP coming in, it is from Rhyme. I mean, the question is, And can he do anything in return here? There's a slightly higher movement speed on Watson's ward, only by 10. Rhyme has got full mana, so the raises are available. And maxed out, I think if he can get one raise on point, that should be enough. One charges have already been used, so Rhyme might be able to get the return kill here.
Yeah, it depends how Watson's ward is able to get out of this situation.
What's the TP time on? He's coming in 1.8. It's going to be close. If he gets him, it's going to be right on the edge of that longest raise.
Yeah, definitely. At the moment, he's well within the longest raise. Yeah. And, I mean, Watson's water has got a creep in front of him. It might make the pathing a little bit more difficult. And I think if he's able to just walk away from this one, he might be absolutely fine. But if he has to do a little bit of darting around side-to-side action around this creep, then he could be definitely in trouble. And Rhyme senses blood.
Let's have a look. Let's see if he goes down. Let's see what Rhyme can do. It's still just under 2 seconds on the TP, so that might be long enough. And the TP reaction is just too long. Yeah, he gets himself past the creeps, no issue at all. Oh, Cook, he's got a bit more of an issue here. Zishiko 1v1ing him in the jungle. Whelp's going to join in for a bit of the action. Shurikens will finish it off, and well, that's the kill there for the side of Zenix, bringing it to 3-for-1 on the board. So finding the kill on the Tusk top, of course, and then subsequently getting the kill in the mid lane as well. Very nice there for the Dire.
Yeah, Whelp is just doing so much work now, and he's managed to find level 4. He's back on target again, and he's also providing a lot of information for his team. He's scouting out where these supports are. He's scouting out the stacks as well, and that's just making it a lot safer for the rest of his team to be able to play aggressive.
He's under the cover of the sentry. He's just on the... Well, he actually came through and pushed out by the shards, but that obviously set him and locked him in place. Yeah, locked him in place for Rhyme to get the raises there. So the ice shards from Corey very nicely controlling the bounty, even though he's still under the cover of Invis. 3-for-2 at the moment, Soodle moving in. He has got that level 7. He's got the Sonic Wave available. Hasn't found an opportunity to use it yet. I mean, Ishiko just having a bit of a fist fight in the mid lane. Ishiko's going to back off. He's going to head down to bottom. Will find himself this Invis. So might be able to make something happen, especially if he decides to go and use it with Soodle.
I think Soodle's realised that Toto's down here on his own as well, and Beezer's backed out of the lane, and he has more than enough burst damage to be able to bring down this Disruptor. So Toto playing very, very safe behind his tower.
And Ishiko, moving in with the Invis, he's going to check out what's going on in the jungle. The stack will be successful, and he's going to know it's there. Bottom lane, pings are coming out, but now Beez has returned to the lane. There's going to be a glimpse on Welp. They've caught him out with the sentry and the kinetic field. Nowhere for this bounty hunter to run, and well, that's going to be a kill for Beezer. Handed to him on a plate. Mid lane, what's going on here? There she goes. Just getting forced back by Rhyme. Monkey getting themselves a killer, and this is what you don't want to be doing, giving kills away to the PL.
Definitely not. Ichigo in the mid lane, he's actually taking a hell of a lot of damage from the heal, and he's going to go down as well. That one's going to go the way of the Rhyme right click, and that's going to be a nice little bit of gold going into his pocket. Has got the treads finished on top of the Aquila as well.
And also at the same time, Tusk managed to find a kill on the top lane onto the Witch Doctor. So kills happening all across the map, but overall a 2-for-1 favouring the side of Monkey over the last minute or so. Let's see what the next move is here from both sides. It looks like Cook's just going to remain here, creating these stacks for Rhyme. Actually switch over to have a look at the net worth of these heroes. What are we seeing? It is Rhyme at the top, 4.7k. And if he can get that stack as well, it's going to be more. Corey kind of going on Watson's water. There's the backup here from Moot. He doesn't have the death ward yet, but if he can get the bounces as well with the Maledict and the Rocket Barrage, it's going to be more than enough. And Zenix will pick up that kill onto Corey. Now we've got a glimpse onto Watson's water. Cook's down with the kinetic field as well, controlling him. Cook might lose his life. He's got the Shallow Grave, but it's enough to buy him the time to find the kill onto the Gyro. Moot trying to get that final right click in. Will get the Dazzle in return. Whelp's turned up as well. Two heroes dying on the side of Monkey. They do lose the Gyro. Okay. Oh, two went in, balls to the wall there, and did manage to clear off Disruptor as well. So very, very favorable bit of play there for Zenix overall. And it's 6-for-6 on the board now.
Yeah, it's the sort of classic Stoodle that we've seen so far in this tournament. He rotates off the lane as soon as he's got that burst damage online and looks to try and find kills, and it's the first time in the game that we've been able to see it executed perfectly.
Indeed, now heading back towards the mid. Well, how's he doing in terms of XP? He's coming up to the latter portion of his level 4, so still looking for that level 6. Beezer with the drums and the Aquila. He's starting to stat himself up, so a little bit harder to be locked on, down and taken out. And you look at the lockdown from the side of Zenix, and in reality, it's not that great for controlling a Phantom Lancer.
No, look at these stacks that Rhyme's got in the mid lane as well. Dazzle's been stacking for him. He's already top of the net worth. He's going to be accelerating his farm even more. And I mean, this is what we mentioned in the draft. If Rhyme can get a decent start, then he might be able to just carry his team to victory.
He's got the Yasha here as well, so it's increased mobility and increased ability to get around the camps and get around the lanes and keep that farm game up. It's going to be very nice for him. He's nearly touching onto that level 11 as well. Ishiko is certainly falling behind in terms of XP and the farm as well. About a 2k difference here between the two mid laners. So quite a sizable one, bottom lane, a bit of action. Static Storm's going to get dropped down. Welp getting caught up by the Lance and the Razors as well. Blarney don't rhyme, will find the kill. Turns to Watson's Water. There's Beezer here as well with the Requiem. Watson's just taking too much damage. The Spirit Lance follows through and they're going to get two kills here on the bottom lane. And this time, Zenix just don't have an answer. Tsoodle's out of there, still 40 seconds before he's got the Sonic Wave available again. And no help being offered by the rest of the team, realizing that that was just a fight that they kind of overstepped the market a little bit, and there was no way that they could rectify it. Now, well, Rhyme and Beezer, they're going to get the push on, and they might be able to find this tier 1 here as well. TPs have actually come out to the top lane. Welp moving in. Moves there as well. Now, level 7 has got that death ward if they want to try and fight and pick off Corey. Also, Tsoodle coming in as well with a haste rune. Corey's in quite a bit of trouble here. He's stuck between three of the heroes. Will fire out the snowball straight away onto Tsoodle. Tsoodle's just going to move himself out of there. War's Punch will connect. Now, he just turns around, gets the right clicks in. In comes the cask, and well, they should be able to finish that one off, and Zenix will find the kill onto Corey.
Yeah, Bounty Hunter now very, very close to his level 6 as well. So once he's got that online, expect him to be even more active around the map. And it's not like he's been exactly stationary at the start of this game.
He's been very mobile.
And once you start getting that influx of gold as well, it really can make a difference, especially if the game is very, very close or you've fallen behind a little bit, which Ichigo kind of has. In terms of his farm, he's not quite as got as much farm as the Shadow Fiend of Rhyme on the opposing team. And that's just simply because of the efficiency that we talked about of Monkeys. They've been able to make those stacks. He's been able to find a hell of a lot from the jungle. And Ichigo is still just working his way by the looks of it towards the drums. So that's going to allow him to fight a little bit earlier as well. And I think that's exactly the timing you want to be going for, because he's probably going to have that. In fact, he's got that finish now. He's going to have it for when the Bounty Hunter gets that track online. And then I imagine we're going to see a lot of aggression coming from the side of Zenix.
Yeah, I mean, and they need it as well, because we talked about the fact that they feel that the Ember Spirit can do something about the PL. They're going to need to do something about him. I mean, he's got two kills, one assist, hasn't died at all, really hasn't received that much pressure in lane. And Beezer now, he's getting to the point where he's coming up to 1k ahead of the Gyrocopter. And they certainly need to try and look for a fight themselves if they want to push that PL back into position. And mid lane, Ichigo coming out. The actual smoke from the side of Monkey, they were looking towards the top lane potentially. But top lane, bit of action coming out as Corey's been caught out. Will throw down the snowball, but Tsoodle should be able to clean this one up. Can get back in the screen. He's also got the Sonic Wave as well if he wants to use it. War's Punch will come out and tell from Corey, but they turn it around. Find the kill. Now Beezer actually teeping in. Picks up a very early boost of travel, so he can offer himself into these early fights. Moving on to Welp. Welp is going to be able to get himself out with the Invis, and Beezer just turns his attention towards the Witch Doctor. Cooldown coming in from Watson's going to be doppelganged off. The Death Ward coming out as well, but Cook's there to back up the PL. They found the kill onto the Witch Doctor. Now Beezer trying to move forward. Static Storm and Kinetic Field are thrown down. Ichigo, the Thunder Strike's onto him. Spirit Lance coming back out to Watson. Cook trying to back himself out. Beezer's hiding the tree line. They'll get a kill. Double kill here for the Dazzle. And it's just going to end a 2-for-1 here, as the full rotation there from the side of Monkey really paying off and allowing them to take that fight, and off the back of it, potentially this tier 1 as well.
Yeah, the Bounty Hunter, he did manage to pop level 6 during that, so he has got that now online. And, well, it looks like they were looking for the Bounty Hunter actually in the corner as Toto pops the dust. But they're not going to find anything there, and they just take the tier 1 tower on the top lane, again going the way of Dazzle. He's got quite a bit of gold over the last 30 seconds or so.
And they're happy with the tier 1. They're going to back up and continue to farm. Beezer, of course, thanks to that fight, being involved in 2 more kills, 2 kills and 3 assists. He's well and truly getting out of control. Have a look at the overall graph difference. And after that fight, starting to break away here, the side of Monkey. It's still very early days here for the side. And of course, any game where there's a Bounty Hunter, there's always the potential to turn it on his head. And if they can find kills like this, as Corey just going a little bit too far into enemy territory. And unfortunately for Corey, he's died a lot this game. 5 deaths on this Tusk. 2-5-2 at the moment on his scoreboard, so just needs to be a little bit more careful potentially and just look to kind of fight with this team about, because every time he oversteps the mark and goes across the river, he's in a big danger zone against this lineup of Zenix.
Yeah, interesting item choice as well from Beezer, going straight for the boots of travel before we see anything like treads into the diffusal, which would be more of a standard build. And he tends to like to do this. We've seen it a couple of times so far in this tournament, and it allows him just to play very, very aggressively, farm a long way on the enemy side of the map, but always be able to come back and join fights. And it's just if you're able to get it this early on, I think it's a really, really nice pickup for himself.
Yeah, absolutely. His farm efficiency is just going to increase tenfold as well. And as I was saying, it's going to be hard for Watson's Water to keep up. He's clearing out a stack himself here in the jungle, but well, I really kind of feel they need a big fight if they want to kind of put themselves back at the head of this game. And Rhyme, with the farm, he's got on top of that Yasha now. He's just 900 or so short of finishing a completed BKB, which is going to be at a very respectable timing indeed, considering the items that he's already picked up.
Yeah, I mean, he's already 3.5k net worth above that of the Ember Spirit. And at this stage in the game, that is a really, really big difference. And, well, now it's actually going to be Monkeys that are going to try and look to take the fight. They feel like they've got the advantage. They've got the item beneficials as well. And they're going to smoke themselves up in the mid lane. Weave's going to come out.
Straight into the jungle here. And they might just find Mute and Welp. There's no sentry ward down here for the Radiant, so the dust will come out, and they're spotted out. Welp now with a glimpse as well. Bounty Hunter in so much trouble. Rhyme now in a dominating kill streak as he takes that one very, very easily there, thanks to the dust thrown out by his supports. It's 11 for 9 at the moment. Monkey here with the lead. Question is, do Ishigo's stack have it in them to bring this one back round? Seal at the moment, he's looking forward to picking up his potential Aghanim Scepter. He's already half the way there with the point booster in the Ogre Club. It's going to be fairly nice against this lineup, especially with the kind of frequency of the skirmishes we've seen. I mean, we're only 17 minutes in and there's 20 kills on the board already.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that we've seen him do a couple of times, and it does suggest that Zenix do have a timing when they want to be able to take fights, and they want to take fights constantly, be able to take objectives off the back of it, and one of those timings is going to be this Aghanim Scepter over on this Queen of Pain.
Well, talking about wanting to take fights on the side of Zenix, it's that point where Monkey, they just want to fight themselves. They group up as five, they're going to look for this tier two here. And you've got to ask yourself, with the Weave and with the Dazzle, it's just so hard for them to fight into Zenix, and they've just got to let this tier two go. And that's some free gold into the pocket of the side of Monkey as they'll just back up and look to go elsewhere potentially. And you've got to remember, at this point of the game, Zenix still yet to take a tier one from the side of Team Monkey. Razor. Get spotted out here. There's actually going to be a blink away from Zula to the high ground. Now they're going to move back in. Ishigo moving forward. Sonic Waves come out with the Searing Jet. It's going to connect now. The Snowball coming forward. They're trying to turn it, but Beza will fall. They'll get the kill onto the PL, and they might even get more here. Chasing down Corey. Zula and Ishigo. They'll find the Searing Jet. That's going to be a double kill for Ishigo. And now Zenix turning this one on his head, and they've got four mid. They'll look to finish off this tier one. What do they look for now? They're going to back up. The Weave's landed on them all. Pings are coming out to the sidelines. Maybe seeing if they can spot anyone out looking for a flank. Rhyme is there in the jungle. Welp will lead the way. That was a very, very nice bit of action there for Zenix, getting themselves two kills and not losing anything in trade.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, the double damage coming out from Ichigo, it was just the perfect timing to be able to pick up that sort of rune. And he was able to do so much damage to those two heroes. Double kill for them, and that's going to help him get a little bit closer to this Shadow Fiend in terms of net worth, who is still finding stacks in this jungle and has that BKB finish now as well. And do you imagine that he's going to finish the Manta style, or do you expect this to be maybe be an SMY Shadow Fiend?
I'll be interested to see what Rhyme opts for. I feel he's gone for both in the past, so yeah, I'll be interested to see what he feels is going to be the best against Zenix's lineup.
Yeah, we've seen him do it before. We've seen him hang on to a lot of gold, actually, on top of the Yasha, and wait and see what the Queen of Pain is going to actually pick up. And once he sees the sort of timings that the Queen of Pain is going to get for the Aghanim Scepter, he can maybe work out whether the Orchid is going to be online at a time that he's going to need that Manta Star for. But at the moment, he's just hanging on to his gold, buying a TP, and he looks like he's going to join the rest of his team, and they maybe want to fight again.
Yeah, and they'll especially want to fight when Beza picks up what I'd imagine to be that defusal after the bots. Yeah, that's the second Blade of Alacrity done, so he's only sitting at about, what, 800 gold away from finishing off that robe and getting that recipe online. And then, once they've got defusal PL, it's going to be infinitely harder for Zenix to fight into, especially when you look at the cores and Ojaro. He's still a good 1,600 gold away from being able to complete off his own BKB. And Emsprit now with the two swords, just needs to find that goal for the Perseverance. That's about 1,600 to go for that. And he will have his Battle Fury online, and that's going to be at a point where it does make it a little bit harder for Monkeys to be able to push high ground, which of course they are yet to do so, as they'll almost certainly focus on trying to remove the other tier twos before pressuring that top lane any heavier.
Yeah, I think the thing is, like, obviously they can get the PL to a point where he's so tanky. If Ichigo doesn't have the items to be able to match him, you know, those crits, the deadlesses, then he's not going to actually be able to kill the illusions quick enough. And that's something that, you know, Monkeys, they probably have that in mind. Beza is such a quick farmer, and he's obviously got those boots of travel, as we mentioned, so he's going to be finding farm all over the map. They can even decide to split push if they want to, fight with the Shadow Fiend. With the Shallow Grave, of course, it's such a strong combination. Shadow Fiend just outputs so much damage through prolonged fights. And if they wanted to do that, then that is also the potential for Monkeys as well.
Yeah, very nice as well. Rhyme did opt. He opted for the Blink Dagger after the Ashes, so, which is going to be nice in these team fights, especially if Disruptor's able to catch people out on the edge of it. glimpsing them back into a static storm kinetic field. Rhyme's going to be able to get himself straight on top of them and look for the massive Requiems. And here we go. He might just see that now. Wasp's Water getting dragged back. Wolf's Punch will be there soon. Look at the Sonic Wave. We'll just connect onto Corey. And there's your blink forward. Rhyme with the BKB, the Requiem. Wasp's getting low. Will go down as the Snowball connects. Question is, can they find anything in return? Moving in onto Corey, won't get the searing chains. The right click should just be enough. Remnant take forward. He's not actually going to go for it here. Well, the shuriken bounces will do it, and they'll find the Tusk kill. Well, he's been popped down, and Beez has turned up the fight. He's going to look to go in, backing off the paralyzing cast, holding back the PL. Might just save the life of a Witch Doctor. And looks like Xenix will be able to disengage, and it is just the one for one, but of course favoring the side of Monkey as they lose the offlane, but take down the core position one from the side of Xenix.
It was a track kill as well, though, going the way of Xenix, so that does help negate a little bit of the damage of losing the position one hero. And they've done enough to be able to defend against the tier two tower. They haven't lost too many heroes, and more importantly, they've held on to their objectives, which is something that they really, really need to do. Because, I mean, that is one thing that maybe this lineup does lack a little bit. It is actually, you know, a little bit of pushing on towers. It's not really, you know, Ember Spirit isn't really a hero that's known for pushing down towers, more for dealing large amounts of damage in team fights. And defending high ground, so it might be a little bit of a problem. I mean, we haven't seen too many towers taken by Xenix so far. There's still, you know, two of the tier ones are still up, and they're going to have to be able to get to a point where they can take two or three heroes from the side of Monkeys before they're going to be able to push too many objectives.
Yeah, I feel that this is potentially the game plan for Xenix, just to sit back, wait for Monkey to come to them, and try and turn the fights on its head, and then look for the aggression and the pushing later on, because as we said at the start, a greedy lineup that is with the Ember Spirit and the Gyrocopter. Late game is going to be essentially a nice place for them, but of course the PL is still going to be an issue. That very, very scary carry potential. And Bees are playing it as well. Diffusal Blade complete and coming up to 1k gold here as well. You're going to see them smoke up and they're going to look for Watsons. And Watsons has maybe come a little bit too far away from home. Cooldown will come out. There's even going to be the TP in from Beezer as well. He wants to be a part of that and will be able to pick up an assist with his involvement. Turning up to the fight at the end. And well, that's Yajiro down for 40 seconds. Sonic Wave comes out. We'll just clip Rhyme. And Seal backs himself off. And it's going to be interesting to see how aggressive Monkey want to try and go whilst they know that this Jaro is off the pitch for 30 seconds.
Yeah, and we talked about maybe a little bit of lack of push of Xenix. Well, Monkey's definitely out short of push and wave clear as well, and they're going to be able to just go straight up to high ground. They don't even care. They're just going to go straight onto the tier threes, 23 minutes in, 24 minutes into the game, and Gyrocopter down for another 15 seconds. That is a lot of your defense right now. You can't defend with just an Ember Spirit who hasn't even got the Battle Fury finished yet.
Throwing out the casket, trying to do what they can. 5 seconds before Gyro's back. Monkey, though, see if they can get this tier three and then maybe back up. I mean, at the same time, they might feel confident in fighting. Yeah, looks like it's just going to be a tier three, play it safe, get themselves out of it, and look to continue their control of the map and continue to keep their cores at the top of the farm game. 14k coming up on Rhyme. He's nearly 5,000 ahead of the 9k on the Ember Spirit. And PL in response to the Jaro, there's about 2.5k difference in it as well. We'll have a look at the overall graph, and after that push, it's only around 3k. There's Xenix with the kills that they found, and of course with that track gold as well. That's really kind of keeping them in it, I feel, at this point.
Yeah, definitely. The track goal obviously makes a big difference, and if you can take even engagement at this point, I think that's something that Xenix will be absolutely happy to do.
Yeah, just keeping this game at a bit kind of a more of an idle position, indeed, so they can just feed off the benefits of this bounty as much as possible.
How many times have we seen this, though, from Monkeys? The way that they just control the map in the enemy's jungle, they get themselves loads of vision, they farm up the enemy's camps, and they just restrict the farm that the Xenix are able to find, and they've got to do something about it, and that is going to be this smoke up as Ichigo leads the way.
Oh, Searing Chains unfortunately latching onto the two neutrals there. A little bit unlucky there for Ichigo, who does of course have the Battle Fury complete, worth noting. So already on his way to making that build that should be able to help them deal with the PL. As we say that, the Beez, 2,200 gold to spend. And it's going to be interesting to see what he does opt for here as his next big item. We have seen, I believe it was the Beezer PL before, where he decided to pick up the BKB on the hero, just so we could fight early on. And BKB could do quite a lot this game, but at the same time, he might feel happy with Rhyme just being there on the front line, and he'll look to build into a more damage oriented. And it looks like it's going to be that. He picks up the Yasha, and he'll probably look to just finish that, of course, into that Manta style.
Yeah,
as soon as he can.
I think so. I think picking up the BKB is not something you really want to be doing.
No, you never
PL.
Want to.
You're kind
you
of forced,
forced
into
to.
It. Yeah. And this game, I don't think he necessarily needs to. I think he can afford to go into that Manta style and be a little bit greedier with his item pickup. Because Rhyme's had a great start, and he's able to stand on the front line, and he's actually reasonably tanky with the BKB as well. So they should be able to take fights without Beezer having to get, getting bursted down by something like a Lina or a track.
4,100 gold here on right. So he has to complete off that Yashir into anything, so maybe he's got kind of bigger items on the mind. And we'll see if he maybe opts towards something like potentially a Butterfly or the MKB if he really wants to excel his damage, maybe even a Daedalus at this point. Visa just making the most of the map, heads up to the top, sees her lane free. Moot there has found himself the medallion. Really wants to be very careful about revealing himself, and he's just going to TP straight out of that lane. Does not want to hang around whilst there's a PL there. Cook working towards that Glimmer Cape. Corey with the mech complete, 700 gold on top. And again, finding himself another ancient stack that has been created for him, so still just keeping themselves so efficiently farmed. And Zenix, they've got a lot of doing, a lot of fighting to do if they want to keep themselves on top. And as the game kind of stales and progresses, we are going to see the gold difference go back in favor and continue to rise and rise for the side of Monkey, unless Zenix can find those skirmishes and find those track kills.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, Rhyme sitting on nearly 4.4k gold again, and just waiting to see what his next item is going to be. But just the efficiency of Monkeys is just brilliant to be able to see. They're just so, so efficient at this farming, stacking constantly, being able to find levels on the supports as well, who then take lanes while the cores are farming those stacks. And well, they're going to push up to high ground again, looking to try and just take down this Rax.
And what is Zenix's answer? What are they going to be able to do against this? It looks like they'll lose the range Rax at least. They might feel competent sticking around for more, especially with Rhyme now picking up completed Butterfly 28 minutes in. And of course, no sign of anything like an MKB anywhere on the horizon for these cores of the side of Zenix. So that evasion is going to do a hell of a lot for the Shadow Fiend, increasing his effective HP pool.
Yeah, very, very nice. And I mean, interestingly there, they obviously know that the Battle Fury is finished over on the Ember Spirit. And rather than all stacking up to the high ground, they just leave Rhyme there to beat down on the Rax, and the rest of them just stand in the back waiting for any kind of counter initiation. So perfect positioning coming out from Monkeys for that high ground push.
Back to the mid. Zenix being very careful where they make the step, make the move. They've been smoked up, and they actually said, we're looking for something. Didn't quite find it. There's a DD bot, also Roshan there as well. I mean, if the side of Monkey catch this, I'm sure they'll go for it here. There's no reason not to really at this point, because I don't know if Zenix can contest that Rosh very favorably, especially when they're in a position where they are being forced back into their own base, into the high ground, and having to be very, very careful with what movements they make.
It's just a great job at the moment of Monkeys being able to control the map and, like you say, forcing them back as far as possible. And yeah, I'm sure Roche will be next on their mind as head towards the Roche pit. And this DD is going to make it even more more appetizing for them.
Yeah, just trying to get the D ward out first. And they're going to be fortunate in the sense that nothing is up here, apart from the sentry, which isn't going to do anything about this Roche attempt that they'll look for. And in comes Ryan, grabs himself the DD in with the Butterfly and the Yasha. They're going to be able to make very, very short work of this Roshan. And as we were saying, it doesn't look like Zenix will be able to do anything in response. The pings are coming out. They sent some things up, but Beez is already there on the high ground. Has the SMY complete?
Itchy goes a ballsy and player. He wants to maybe go for this one.
Shards being thrown out, but it's just too late. They're going to be able to get it.
No, Beez
are double gaming forward. That's going to be it. Just scaring back Zenix. And now, well, with this, they're probably going to look to try and just face roll Zenix and force down this bottom lane, take the tier 2, and maybe just even move onto the base. And even with some of the duration of this DD left as well.
Yeah, I mean, they were comfortable just throwing Rhyme up onto the high ground when he only had one life. Now he has two, and Beez has also picked up a Sanjin Yasha as well, actually upgraded the Diffusal Blade too, so maybe just looking to jump onto the Ember Spirit, burn a lot of his mana, force him to get away from the fights. And at the moment, Monkey's completely in control.
Ryan getting caught out here, does have the Aegis, Death Ward's been popped down, but look at the armor and the evade. He just doesn't care, he's going to be able to walk it off. Shallowgrave was there just in case. Tearing Chains, they're going to latch onto Beezer this time, but he's got the doppelganger, moves himself back. And looks like they'll just hang out here, top themselves back up until they're ready to move back in.
Yeah, I thought the Maledict might do a little bit more there, but it is actually still only a level 1, favoring the heal instead, so very minimal damage coming out on Rhyme, and he's still got that Aegis, of course, stepping up to the high ground, chipping away at this tier 3 tower, and it's looking like it's very, very difficult for Zenix to be able to defend this.
Missile's going to come out onto him, but still the Aegis picked up a helm as well, so continuing to find items, even whilst he's just focusing on pushing rather than farming. I mean, he's just soaking up the waves as they come out, keeping the pressure on the base, cooldown bringing him low, but again, Rhyme's absolutely fine, and he's getting to that scary point where Zenix just can't seem to deal with this SF that's just being forced right up into their faces and pushing up these lanes. And the tier 3 takes a bit of damage, and it looks like Monkey, they'll offer a bit of mercy at this moment in time, not looking to force the issue anymore. But I'm sure when they do, it's still going to be infinitely harder and harder for Zenix to fight back with the amount of farm that they continue to get under their belts.
Yeah, it's almost like Monkeys are heading up to the high ground, sort of testing the waters. Are we strong enough to be able to take a fight right now? And then when, you know, Rhyme gets a little bit low, they decide to back themselves away, farm up a few more items, and then try again. And at the moment, Zenix, I mean, they're able to defend that one at least. They don't lose the tier 3 tower, they're still standing. But you have to say they are in an uncomfortable position right now. They have two cores that need a hell of a lot of farm, and they're not being able to find enough around the map.
Not at all. I mean, on top of the BKB, 1800 on Watson's Water, so still a fair bit away from picking up that real first big damage item here, which he's going to need, because they're going to have something that's going to be able to bring Rhyme down.
1600 HP, 17 armor straight up. Factor in that, the Dazzle's heal and the Weave as well. It's going to be harder and harder for them to bring down this SF. And here comes the pressure, potentially Rhyme. Moving up to the top with Corey as well. Looks like they want to try and finish off this melee. Rat's cooldown will be thrown out straight away by Rhyme. I don't think he cares, he just stands there, punches away. Slider for Searing Chase coming out, he's down to half health. Death Ward's been dropped, but the Guardian Breach, they should be able to bring him down once, but you know the Snowball's there to bring him out of it. They're moving on to Watson's Water. Rhyme does go down, they lose the Aegis here. And now we see Ishigo trying to do what he can with the Slider Fist for the defense. Warrior's punch onto Watson's Water. Sonic Wave comes out, bringing Corey low. BZ just focusing the racks. Rhyme gets himself back in position with the punches, trying to finish it off. Pops the BKB, and now here's your Requiem of Souls. They want to try and fight the slow and the damage reduction on Watson's Water. He gets brought back straight into the static storm. It's going to hit Phil. Gyro will fall. He's down for 1 minute. Does have buyback available. Might just need to use it as the top racks get cleared out. Rhyme heads towards the mid lane, looks to find this tier 3. And at the moment, Zenix are just kind of tucking their tails between the legs and hiding in the base. Ishiko's come back out. Slider Fist is there with the Searing Chains to connect, but again, here's the damage there. Tsoodle's come in. Delayed seconds before he's got the Sonic Wave. The cast will bounce, but the Shallow Grave's there. Rhyme tries to turn around. The Snowball picks him up. It's incredibly low. Will go down. They managed to kill the SF. Can they kill more? The Dazzle's still alive, healing them up on the back line. Corey will fall. It's going to be a double kill for Ishiko. Maybe they're doing it, but Beezer's there. And I think Beezer might just be able to clean this one up on the PL. He's found Watson's Water. They've also lost the Gyro, and that, of course, was a dieback. Beezer's still alive. Mute and Ishiko will maybe look to try and chase him down. It's actually going to be Corey that falls as well, so they do find three heroes from the side of Monkey. And well, you and Ishigo are still alive here, and they are going to spot out Beezer. And the question is, do they want to try and jump on this? No, well, it's going to be Beezer jumping on them, moving in with the Diffusal Blade onto Mute. You'll find the Witch Doctor who just simply stands there, realizes his fate is inevitable. Ishigo turning up, looking for the Searing Chains. We'll actually find out onto Beezer, but Beezer's just going to just fight this. He's going to leave it. Okay, he's a little bit too scared that the Whelp might be in position to do something, but Whelp
nice
moves
under
the sentry. Indeed, that sentry reacts incredibly nice. Looking for Whelp, blocking him so he stays under the cover. It drops another one just in case he gets out. And Beezer now on a dominating streak. Four heroes down on the side of Zenix. None with buyback available. And now
brilliant
at this point,
awareness
Monkey just looks
Cook
to go for the base, potentially.
Yeah, brilliant awareness by Cook. He pops down the sentry, realizing the Bounty Hunter might be in the vicinity, and they get themselves an extra bonus kill. Beezer doesn't die in that engagement either. He's now 6-1 and 5 on this PL. And he even finds the courier as well.
Indeed, pain after pain here for the side of Zenix. As yeah, Beezer, with the money he's got a fully complete heart, 1300 gold on top of it as well. As we saw, SF with his Mansa style complete as well.
It was the Daedalus recipe on the courier as well.
The Daedalus recipe. And they needed that. They really need some extra kind of damage. One set of racks down, tier 3 down in the mid lane, and tier 3 on the bottom lane looking well and truly battered.
I think they did manage to catch the courier as it was going towards the secret shop. Ichigo trying to save it at the last minute. He has still got 2,700 gold, and he obviously did need that demon edge to be able to complete the Daedalus, having already picked up the recipe. But, you know, I mean, the fact that the recipe was on the courier is maybe a little bit of a misplay. He could have left that one in base, sent the courier, and it wouldn't have dropped anything at all. And then he'd have at least been able to walk out towards the secret shop and pick that Daedalus.
The fact that if he'd gone out, it wouldn't have been the courier dying. It would have potentially been him dying.
Been
so, you know, in that kind of light, maybe not the worst bit of action for Zenix, but nonetheless, it's looking a bit rough for them here.
Yeah, it's one of the great things about the Disruptor, because you always think you can be fairly safe as the Ember Spirit if you've got a Remnant out to safety, but when there's a Disruptor on the field, you can never be safe. That glimpse range is just absolutely huge.
There we go, Sonic Wave. Mantis onto Rhyme. Cast will come out. They've got the Death Ward, but he just mantles it off and heads himself away. Illusions will continue to potentially even finish off this tower here. I'm bringing it incredibly low. Siege Card trying to do it. One more will do it. Oh, can't quite get it out, but the tower falls anyway. We'll find the deny with the Witch Doctor. but now it's the rest of the racks exposed here in the base. BZ just sending the illusions in, and of course with that heart, proving very tanky and hard to deal with.
Yeah, the reality is right now there's no way that Zenix can really leave their base. They're going to have to try and take a fight, or they're going to have to try and prolong this game for another sort of 10, 15, 20 minutes or so before they can even get into a position where they can make a comeback. And, well, Ranger Rat's going to go down in the mid lane. Maybe this is the fight they're looking for. Mutant's going to drop down the death ward.
He's got to run.
Oh, no, he's got to run. Shadowfiend's just way too strong right now with the BKB. He just keeps beating on the racks. He's playing objective gaming Rhyme. And meanwhile, Beez is just being the nuisance. He's jumping himself around in the fights, just draining everyone's mana with that defusal blade. And, well, mid lane, Rax is gone.
And Ian Ryan just turns his attention towards the bottom, heads towards Ishiko, gets those punches in. Snowball's going to follow through. Ishiko, does he have a remnant out? Yes, he does, and he will be able to escape from that. Watson's Water, he's been defusal now with a glimpse as well. Brought back. No, he will be able to get himself out as he pops the BKB to survive. But nonetheless, rather the side of Monkey, they'll just face themselves with the Rax and look to find the Mega Creeps here for the team, and they're going to get them, and suddenly, well, I say suddenly, it was slowly but surely, Zenix in an incredibly bad position. Ishiko almost suddenly got a fall in. GG is called. Monkey will take the first game of this series, and it's 2-0 at the moment in this best of
five. One game a win from, you know, taking home the back grand prize. And yeah, I mean, just perfectly played by Monkeys. We talked all through the game about their efficiency, and again, they were just way more efficient than Zenix in that game. And just wearing them down, wearing them down, wearing them down, and eventually they were able to break through and take lanes of Rax.
Yeah, absolutely. As we can see, well, on the scoreboard, just showing how well the PL played. Beezer, 7 kills, only dying the once. We talked about the fact that Zenix were very worried about a PL carry and how strong they felt the hero was. And we talked about the pairing with it, with Beezer, one of the, or if not the strongest carry on the UK scene. And I wouldn't be surprised if we don't see PL get through again in this series.
Yeah, I'd be very surprised if Zenix like that get that through for game two, or game three, as we suppose we could say, because it is a one-map advantage. And yeah, I mean, the Phantom Lancer was obviously great as well, and they thought they had the Ember Spirit to deal with it, but Ichigo just wasn't able to find the farm that game, and that was the real problem for them. And Rhyme just got absolutely stacked on that Shadow Fiend, and in the end of the day, he was the real one that made the difference at the end when they were looking to take the Rax. He was just standing up there alone, tanking through everything, had that BKB, of course, as well. And yeah, it was just perfectly played by Monkeys.
Absolutely, but we will be, of course, back for game three, which will be right around the corner. We'll just have a short 10-minute break, so don't go anywhere if you're watching at home. And hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back for some more of this grand final LAN hype here between Zenix Gaming and Monkey. We're about to get game two underway effectively, but we've got to remember that Monkey came into this with a one-game advantage, did win the first game of this series, so now they're at 2-0 and one game away from taking the tournament. I'm Odie Pixel, and I'm here joined by Dave. Dave, how are you doing?
Not bad, not bad. How are you?
I'm good. I'm looking forward to this one.
Yeah, it's been exciting games throughout this tournament so far with these two.
From both teams. Yeah. I mean, in your eyes, who is the stronger side? Is it Monkey Clear, or do you feel that Zenix can take a game against them?
I think, independently, the players on Monkey are a lot stronger mechanically. This is also provided, they're given a strong backup, I think, from Cook and Cook and Toto. But I think, as a team, I think Zenix have put a lot of work in to the scrims recently, and they've shown they can beat teams that have beaten them before that also might be individually stronger skilled. So hopefully with the...
We've got to see this drop. But first of all, we do just want to show you a poster. We've got some Beezer fanboys here in the studio. I don't know if there we go. Fantastic. And as we can see, Beezer is indeed looking for a 7K girlfriend, and 6K is negotiable. So please do indeed get in touch with these lads who have joined us from the University of Warwick. So shout out to the Dota 2 Society that's come down to the LAN for that. But let's get ourselves into the draft now, as it is underway, and I think you guys need to see what's being picked up here. We talked about, well, not necessarily unconventional anymore, but kind of fun picks from Zenix Gaming, and it's the TUS Techies.
Yeah, I think EG pioneered this really at TI, where it showed off to the world stage. And of course, like I think they gave up the Leshrac pick.
They did, that's the one thing.
Because they wanted to get that TUS Techies, because we have seen TUS banned a lot in the first two stages of a lot of recent competitions. So to get the TUS Techies was Zenix was actually discussing this before this game even started.
They've
been saying this for the past couple of days, like, we're going to pull out TUS Techies. Yeah. And just before this game started, I was told that this was the game. It was like, we're going to go hell for leather. We're going to make sure that we can do as much as we possibly can.
It's going to be interesting to see how well it works. As you said, they do give away the Lesh, and they do give away yet again the PL. I mean, me and Wakey were talking about that after the first game. Is there the potential for them to ban out the PL? But they opt for taking away, again, Corey's Darkseer and the Dazzle. We saw that the Dazzle did a lot of work on the Dazzle in game one. So understandably removing that from the side. Bans from the side of Monkey, pretty much standard against the lineup of Zenix. Again, removing Ishigo's Amber. Didn't have the best game, but he did all right in that first game and was able to hold off the inevitable defeat for a little bit of time. Yeah. Bounty Hunter's taken away this time, and they'll remove the Wyvern. And Zenix just banning out Rhyme's TA. Monkey getting rid of the Watson's Water AM. One of those heroes that we know Watson pretty proficient on and can carry very hard on.
Yeah, Mew242 actually played that as well. They did a complete lineup swap in the lower bracket finals. Oh, Constellation finals, sorry. So yeah, but this is... this is going to be interesting because, of course, as you said, Phantom Lancer Lesh is your dream first.
it's a very strong.
Like, if you could pick two heroes, you could get, you know, these days, it would be those two. So we're going to see how, you know, of course, Zenix let PSSB get it during the Constellation final, and they managed to actually beat out the Lesh with the Slardar pick.
They did. I mean, Slardar, is that something that we could potentially see again? It worked out very nicely. We did also, of course, see Warlock being run by Ishigo in the mid lane against that Lesh. But, well, in kind of talks with Rami, he didn't seem too scared about the Warlock pick. He was explaining the fact that Lesh should simply just win that lane time and time again. You just stock up with tangos, go in with lots of regen, and then suddenly the heal is something you don't have to worry that much about the damage from.
Also, because of the PL pick, obviously with the Diffusal Blade pick up, the Warlock's effectiveness is going to be reduced.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much that you hit the nail on the head there. It's unlikely, unfortunately, that we'll see Ishigo's Warlock because it is a lot of fun. But I think for Zenix, it's going to be interesting to see how heavily they can punish heroes like the PL and arguably the Lesh as well. You know, before the Lesh gets the Bloodstone, relatively squishy, and if the Tusk Techies combo can be pulled off, these heroes have got to be very, very careful where they step.
Yeah, obviously with the Techies and Tusk in lane, unfortunately, not to be able to kill the Phantom Lancer in lane because of the way the Doppel Warg works.
That's the thing.
But they're going to look to pick up the supports constantly. They're going to look to roam around the map. Maybe kill the Lesh and the Naga comes out as well. These two illusion heroes, you know, just being able to clear out the mines through normal strategic positions.
Yeah, indeed. They're certainly picking around the techies here and dealing with that in that sense. The CM, always fun to see from a side, and obviously nice with the techies and the Tusk as well, you know, with the extra mana regen, just going to allow them to be as active as possible across the map and getting as much done as they can in the earlier stages of this game. And, well, we kind of talk about the earlier stages because you need to get something done there. If you're running against a PL, Lesh, and Naga, but the lineup so far, Zenix really want to be shutting this one down fairly early on.
Yeah, this could be very scary to go into in the mid-game with. Naga's probably going to be, I think it's probably going to be played by Toto. So Cook is probably going to be looking for his hero.
Yeah.
But Toto is a fairly good Naga player, so he's going to look to transition possibly into that carry role, but he might also pick up items like the Guardian Greaves and the Solar Crest, which also work really well.
Yeah, I think, as you said, Toto, we've actually seen him play quite a bit of Visage. We know his micro's good, so I would not be surprised if we see him give us quite a stellar performance on the Naga Siren. We'll see what the fourth pick is now from Zenix. I imagine they're going to kind of run the Tusk Techies potentially on that dual offlane. And CM going to be solo supporting what we'd imagine to be Watson Zero. Well, it's going to be Magnus picked up here. And I mean, you're the UK CNX, but is this going to be an Ishigo Magnus?
Yeah, this is an Ishigo Magnus. He plays it quite a lot. There was a joke for a long while. There was a joke for a long while about Ishigo never hitting an RP.
Okay.
So we'll have to see how he goes.
I have to bring that back up if it becomes relevant in this match. But, yeah, the Magnus is going to be a lot of fun to watch. The fourth pick here from the side of Monkey was the Visage. I mean, I was just talking about how good Toto's micro is with that. Maybe he's doing the Naga with the Visage. I think that's going to be Toto's playing Visage. And it's going to be probably Cook, I'd imagine, on this Naga. Unless they wanted to switch around even more, maybe go with some kind of an orthodox lane situation here, Monkey, if they're feeling confident against Zenix. And after game one, I wouldn't be surprised if they do that and try and react to what Zenix is going to do here in this next game of the series. Final pick here for the side is Zenix, and it's going to be the Juggernaut for Watsons, I'd imagine.
I'm not sure if I like that pick here, because obviously, you know, they've got two illusion-based heroes, and, you know, the ult's going to be bouncing about, but maybe they're looking to do some early sort of push strat with the Techies, Tusk, Magnus, Crystal Maiden. So maybe they want the Juggernaut for the spin, the healing ward to clear creep waves, and also keep the team healthy during team fights.
Yeah, what I do like about the Jug though is it's very good with the Magnus. You know, you can farm at such an insane rate. You get that Empower out onto him, he can just head to the jungle camps, clear them out incredibly quickly, and you can have a CM who's going to be very active in the jungle, looking to create those stacks. So we talked about how well Monkey can stack and how good they are at making the most efficient use of the map. Maybe we'll see Zenix try a bit more of that this game. And also just the RP potential, the kind of follow-up in terms of the CM coming out with the ultimate, even Tusk flying through with a Snowball to add to that stun duration, and Juggernaut flying through with an Omni Slash whilst empowered up. And final pick here from the side of Monkey. And is anyone coming to mind? Well, it's going to be the Bristleback straight up. So it looks like, yeah, it's going to be Lesh in the mid lane being played by Rhyme. Safe lane PL. Yeah, it's going to be the Cook Naga. Yeah. Okay.
So he was almost. I was almost right. I thought it was going to be a Toto Naga.
I thought Toto. Until when we saw the Visage, I guess it kind of gave it elsewhere. But indeed, hello, ladies and gentlemen. We're about ready to get ourselves in as the players pick up their heroes. And so the final one, Corey on the Bristleback. I don't think, I personally, me and Wake, I don't think we've casted any Bristleback games this LAN. Have you seen any Bristleback being picked up?
I don't think so. No, I don't think I've seen a Bristleback game so far this tournament. And I haven't seen Corey play anything else but not Darkseer until the grand stage.
It's true, he's been pretty much playing Darkseer straight up every time they've been allowed to get it. Zenix, of course, in this final very important series, making sure that the side of Monkey don't get their hands on the Darkseer. Now, here we go, the game will begin and we'll get ourselves into what is game two at this best of five, but one game advantage was given to Monkey as they came in from the upper bracket. Now let's see what they can achieve here, and let's see what they can do against a lineup where Zenix are running this Tusk Techies. Now let's see how well Monkey can deal with the Techies. I mean, with the Bristleback, of course, another very tanky hero, potentially going to get to the point where Corey can walk over the smaller clumps of mines and not have to worry too much about it. I mean, in terms of drafts, kind of just drafts overall, what's your kind of look on this, Dave? I mean, are you favouring someone outright here? Do you feel someone stronger?
I think Monkey is definitely in a strong position here because I always favour the late game lineups.
Corey already dealing with a bit of the techie situation there. He should be fine. He's got his back turned, has the salve up. Didn't have to skill up anything there, so we'll be able to save his first point and get potentially those cross sprays. But Meat just gets back on it here on this top lane. Simply just see the side of Monkey look to secure themselves that bottom rune. And Watson is chasing back Corey here, making sure he can't get himself around too freely around this top lane. But it's going to be all about this Techies really and how much Mute can achieve on this hero.
Yeah, I think he's going to be doing a lot of roaming during the game. He's going to look to go around with Tusk because obviously he is up against a Naga PL on the safe lane.
Yeah.
And he's going to really struggle to get anything done there. So maybe they're going to look towards rolling towards mid, getting a few kills on Rhyme, putting Rhyme behind because we you know, there's that classic UK Dota thing, is if you can kill Rhyme a few times, he gets a bit upset.
A bit upset. I mean, it is true. Yeah. I mean, Wakey saw a game indeed where Rhyme, if he kind of makes the wrong decision early on and he gets heavily punished for it, as you said, Zenix turning it around, killing him, there is the potential for him to be thrown a little bit off course, and maybe Zenix can use that to their potential. And if there's any kind of hero that you're going to tilt against, Techies is probably the one to bring out against that kind of player.
Yeah, Techies is definitely an annoying hero to play against. You know, you're walking through the woods, you're dead. There's nothing you can do, especially if he gets his Aghanims, which he might not get at this stage, not at this stage of the game, but during this game, because I think he is really going to struggle to even stay relevant, because he is up against such good heroes versus him.
Top lane, Watson's Water, just chasing down Corey here with the Blade Fury, and doing a fair bit. Of course, the Cell had already been forced out by the Techies' mind, so he's just going to have to tango himself up. Bottom lane, Toto with the harassment, warting back Soodle, making sure the Tusk can't find anything from that bottom lane. But I mean, it's going to be interesting to see how this mid lane pans out. Of course, Rhyme Leshrac, a very formidable thing to go up against. But as you said, Ishigo, he's pretty good on the old Magnus. And obviously, with the Shockwave, should be able to clean out some of the creep waves and keep himself involved in the CS game. But you've really got to just favor the Lesh overall, though, in this matchup.
Yeah, you generally favor Lesh at any sort of matchup in mid lane. You know, there's no one he does badly against. But Magnus should be able to stand back, you know, just inside XP range, just outside lightning range, and just use Shockwave for the last hit, essentially. He's already got his bottle on the way, so he shouldn't be suffering too badly.
And already Mute. He's kind of switching it up, being very, very present globally, and making sure he can do what he can to really catch Monkey off guard and always play one step ahead of them. So they just don't expect the placement. Cook is making the pulls here, clearing out the jungle. Tsoodle's having to go deep here for the XP. Toto is wrapping around. Super going very, very close in, making sure he's involved in the XP game. And Mute has been spotted out here by the Naga Illusion, so they're going to know that there's some mines up in their jungle. Toto just going in, trading the hits here with the Grave Chill, chasing down the Tusk. Nothing more is going to come of it for the time being. And Ishiko, with the ball online, will be able to find himself a Hastrian. And CS so far in the mid lane, a 9-8 on your Lesh, 4-0 on the Magnus. I mean, as you were saying, and as we expected, Lesh and Rhyme having a very, very good time in the mid.
Yeah, Rhyme's obviously played Lesh quite a lot. And it's not a favorable matchup towards any hero, especially essentially a strength melee hero. You know, he's having to use his, he's only got a small mana pool, so he's having to use the bottle more for the mana than the HP a lot of the time, which isn't what you really want to do. You want to be able to use that, you know, the HP regen out of the bottle more so than the mana a lot of the time.
Ishiko trying to do what he can to keep lane. Actually going in with the Hastrian here. Maybe seeing if he can get a position for a skewer. This is a very ballsy play. He's going to get it onto Rhyme. And the backup is there as well. Whelps actually come in with a frostbite. But Rhyme, he just turns it around. He's electric, throws out a lightning, and that's enough to dispel the aggression. And Rhyme, he's going to be A-OK and just bottles himself back up here.
Yeah, it's a good bit of harassment, good rotation, you know. Once you can get the Lesh mana down, and of course the split earth is quite expensive, and if it misses, you know, he's not getting that last hit, he's not getting that harassing, so it works out very good for Magnus.
And they're just doing what they can to slow down Rhyme's momentum. And Mute's still hanging around on the spawn lane with Tsul. As level 2, of course, Suicide is online, so if they do find the capability for that initiation and that opening, and just getting the techies in, dropping a mine down, the snowball and the ice shards, more than enough time to ensure that the enemy gets hit by that mine and following it through with a suicide, you've got a very, very good shot at killing some of these heroes on this bottom lane. Top lane, well, just coming in with a frostbite harass, but Corey at this point, level 3, nearly reaching onto level 4 on this bristleback, feeling fairly confident with how far he's going up out of this offlane.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough matchup for the Juggernaut top here, because obviously, again, melee hero, Bristleback, be able to spray the quills, you know, do a bit of damage to him, harass him out. Because Crystal Maiden hasn't really been doing that much in the lane to zone out the Bristleback. So he's, you know, he's level 4, same level as the Juggernaut does have.
Oh, there we go. That's your first blood there. Using the perfect combo. Just dropping the straight up suicide, and that's exactly what they need. Oh, top lane. What's his water? Only just getting himself out. We'll be able to pop the south. Well, it's going to just be okay, but oh, the rotation from Ishiko catches out the Bristle with a shockwave. And it's Zenix now with 2 kills on the board. And no, Monkey's still yet to find anything, of course. That number 1 just signifying that suicide from Techies. Oh, fantastic rotations there from the side of Zenix.
Yeah, this is what Zenix need to be doing. They need to be present on the map during the early phases of the game. They can't allow Monkey to set into a rhythm of farming, stacking camps, thinking they have the map safe to do what they want. Yeah. They have to get in. Into Monkey's face.
Yeah, this is big for the Magnus. You know, he's having a bit of a tough time in mid, but he's still about 10 CS behind, but the fact that he did get that kill is going to put Ishiko in a much, much better position.
Yeah, I think he's about to get his mana boots, so that'll also help his regen in lane. And then he's almost going to hit level 6 soon. So, you know, with the rotation coming out from Techies there, you know, he can get a couple of kills, but maybe with Suicide Squad and Landmine, I believe.
Yeah, absolutely. He can get the RP and the skewer off. And one thing we haven't really talked about is, yeah, the synergy as well with Magnus and Techies in the terms of being able to reposition the enemy with the skewer on top of a mine clump that's already been created. So we'll see if any of those situations do arise as the game goes on. But 5.5 minutes in the farms on the 2 carries, looking a little bit more favorable for the side of Monkey. Beezer 35-5 compared to Watson's 27-9. But as you were saying, we are kind of expecting the Jug to have not as easy a time because he is up against the Prison. Well, bottom lane, okay, they've lost the Techies. As Naga did manage to find the kill, and they're going to move in for more here, trying to go onto Tsudl. He'll be slowed down here by the Lance, but he'll still be able to walk this one off. And it will just be the Techies going down the bottom lane, but nonetheless, Monkeys getting themselves a kill on the board.
Yeah, that's also important for Monkeys. As we said, you know, Zenix need to pressure early, so what Monkeys need to do is survive the early. You know, they have these really strong, every hero in their team scales really well with XP and farm. So they need to make sure they get to that point of the game where all these heroes become relevant.
Top lane now, Corey. Nearly found his level 6 Jug. Has got the Omni Slash available. Not really enough on its own, though, to deal with the Bristleback. We're actually going to see a bit of a wrap round here coming from Welp. Maybe if they can catch him out of position, they can go, but they're realizing that the creep way is pushing out, and Welp will simply back him and look to come in from an alternate angle. He's got the suicide back online in a couple of seconds, so maybe, just maybe, we'll see Tsul and Mute try and go for that old Tusk Techies combo again. As he's going in with the Omni Slash with the Blade Fury to follow up, they could find this. Welp's trying to move in for the Frostbite. The Blade Fury might be there. The Quill Spray stacking up is not enough. They'll lose the Bristleback. Rhyme's actually TP'd in. Toto as well, now with the Grave Chill onto Welp. Leshrac did manage to finish off the Jug. He's heading up for a one for one. Well, we just pop down the frostbite, pops the stick charges that do just save him. Will get himself out, but they lose the jug for the offlaner. It does force Ryan to rotate and will provide some space in the mid lane for Ishigo. Nonetheless, maybe not the trade that Zenix would have wanted to take there.
No, not quite the trade they wanted, but, you know.
It's not the worst trade.
It's not the worst trade in the world, you know. Bristleback is basically, he's got as much free farm as he wants on the top eight. Welp is unable to really zone out the Bristleback effectively at this point in the game. And if he gets into a position to zone him, he'll actually be in risk of dying. So he needs to be very careful.
Well, now you can see that Tsulami really want to try and make something happen, but as you said, with the doppelganger, very hard to jump onto the Beezer PL.
Yeah, they're basically waiting for the Visage to show in lane. That's the target they're going for. Because, you know, the Naga can always be an illusion. Beezer can always doppelganger away from it. And, you know, it's just a risk using a suicide cooldown to go for essentially an illusion.
Trying to do what they can to hinder the PL's farm, top lane. Corey moving in onto Watson's. Toto is there as well. He can find the grave chip, but now Watson's going to be able to juke it out around the tree line by the rune. Ryan will be able to bottle it up, get himself a double damage. Now Ishiko's got a run. If Ryan can get a lightning onto this, he could be in trouble. Welp needs to be careful as well. One bounce and the CM will die. Now, he hasn't got the vision. Welp will be able to get away. Ryan does manage to cancel the salve. We'll continue to chase her. Looks for the split, but won't find it. And Magnus is going to be okay. Ryan is out of all charges, but then again, so is Ishiko. So both heroes in a similar position now.
Yeah, Magnus actually used RP there. I don't know if he missed it, but I think Ryan was on quite low HP. So I think he hit it, but because Ryan already has the Null Talisman and the Point Booster, he managed to survive there.
And Ryan as well. We've got to remember these stacks that are being created and being cleaned up pretty quickly here by Ryan. They're going to keep him in a very, very comfortable position on top of the Magnus. And this is an issue for Zenix. We're seeing three heroes just having to go back to base. Four, in fact. You know, having to go back and TP back out. So a lot of time being given favoring the side of Monkey and allowing them to make more of the map, and the net worth difference is starting to show here on the individual heroes, as we can see both Rhyme and Beezer finding themselves at the top of the board, and Zenix are going to need to find some action, I feel, with the Tusk Techies if they want to bring their cause back on top of the game.
Ishiko actually picks up an important item for himself there. So, you know, we'll see what he can do when his RP comes back off cooldown in about 40 seconds time.
This is not bad timing as well, 9 minutes.
No, it's not bad. He hasn't got the arcanes, but, you know, having that is always nice.
Roughly, so they're going to keep it to the side here at the moment. So,
there's no point showing until his RP is actually ready to go.
Top lane, they're just going to send Toto back up. He's halfway through five. Not quite found the Visage familiars yet. Zul's just going to TP straight out of this one. As Cook does move in with Beezer, didn't quite have the second net available. And mid lane, actually seeing a very bit of aggressive play here from Ishiko and Mute. Toto has been spotted out here. They're not going to go for it. They're just going to look for the rune here instead. And well, the ping's coming out on Ishiko. They know what's up.
Yeah, they also would have spotted his blink back there. Yeah. They know exactly what he's got. Oh.
Oh, he goes in. Won't find anything with the RP. And now they're just turning it around. Soul Assumption. Ryan moves in. He'll find one. He'll look for techies as well. Does have a suicide. Will pop it. Denies them the kill. But Ryan and Toto there managing to find Ishiko on the Magnus. Have a very nice kill there for the side of Monkey. And the XD coming out to top lane. They want to try and find Corey. Watson's moving in with the help of Welp, but Corey with the 2 points in the bristleback. A little bit too much. Not enough, though, to save him from the Omni Slash as Jug moves in for the finishing blow. And they do get another kill on this Juggernaut. I mean, Watson's water so far, two kills and an assist on himself. Not that bad 10 minutes in for the safe lane Jug.
Yeah, it's going well for him, considering, you know, he was basically almost 1v1 versus that bristleback for quite a while. You know, he's managed to kill him twice now, which is, you know, very important because of the situation on the other lanes of the map. So, you know, hopefully I don't know what he's going to be going for here. I'm guessing he's going to go for the standard SMY build. We'll have to see. He might actually go for the Battle Fury or something similar.
See what happens here. As you said, the fact that it's keeping him in line with Beezer's farm on the PL. If anything, just slightly ahead. So, a lot better position for Watson to be in comparison to Beezer than we saw, at least in the first game. He's certainly keeping his farm on a much more even level. It's just going to be interesting to see what the game plan is here from the side of Zenix. I imagine they'll hold off until Ishiko has got that RP available again, and then maybe they'll try and look to smoke up, TP out to one of the other lanes, and see if they can find an RP initiation onto one of these heroes. Top lane Corey's looking for Watson potentially. Has the backup of Toto, and Toto does have the familiars. He's trying to position him. He's actually going to find the courier here, and he's going to try and take it down. Courier might just fall, trying to get himself away with the familiars. The boost is there just in time. They'll get the courier out, but it looks like Watson won't be as lucky. The stacks from the quills they're onto four. I don't know if the healing ward's going to save him, as Corey's just going to dive this one through. One more quill spray will seal the deal, and they'll find the kill onto the Juggernaut there. This time, no backup. Well, the backup will be there for finding the kill on Toto. Can they find anything more here? He has got the RP available, but Corey bottling up with the one charges as well will be able to get himself out. So it will be them losing the jug. They find the Visage in return. But again, not a trade that Zenix are going to be too happy with.
No, Bristleback picking up about 470 odd gold there. So, you know, a nice chunk of gold for the Bristleback who's died twice previously. So he's going to have his treads now. He's going to probably work towards a blade mail or something similar. Maybe he goes towards the SMY, but I'd imagine it'll be too
late. One lane, Sula's gone incredibly deep here onto Beezer with the Walrus Punch as well, but looks like they'll turn it around. Mute's just going to get himself out of this, realizes it's not the fight to take. And they'll lose the Tusk here on the bottom lane, Zenix Gaming, and nothing quite being done in return. And this is just going to give more and more here to Beezer on the PL. He's gone back to the base to regen up. I'm picking up a Blade of Alacrity here, so with the treads, interesting enough, seeing him go for a different build this game. And may just go for the Treads Diffusal and avoid getting that early boots of travel, which, I mean, looking at the score and the game so far, maybe not feeling as confident as he did in the first game of the series to go straight for that very, very greedy early boots of travel.
Yeah, definitely. This game, he knows he needs to be more influential in fights. He needs to be able to come to a team fight and affect it rather than split push or anything like that. Because, of course, the fight in 5v4 versus Zenix, it's quite easy they can get a four-man wipe onto Monkey there. So we're going to have to... He knows he has to fight, so he's going for the earliest online build he can.
Bottom lane, Sula went in onto Corey, but Cook's there, and it looks like they will be able to turn it around. Sula's trying to run, but again, the stacks of the Quill Spray's building up. Cook will be allowed to pick up that kill. And interesting enough, Beezer didn't even need to be there, realizing that they can hold this lane themselves, and potentially looking for Cook to now start getting the farm on this Naga Siren, and Beezer just utilizing this top lane as he feels he's pretty safe in terms of contesting farm against the Juggernaut.
Yeah, I don't know if Cook's going to transition into like a more of a carry role, or he's just down here for XP for now, because I think they want him to have level 6 for any sort of team fights that come up, because they know the Magnus has Blink, and they just want to make sure that if there is a team fight, that Cook can disengage.
It's worth noting that Ishigo's farm's still pretty good. I mean, he's keeping it in par with the PL position one. He's obviously falling behind Rhyme, but Rhyme, he's been given a lot in the jungle, has found a lot of stacks here that have been created by his team, which is pretty much the playstyle we do see Monkeys. They normally kind of, as a team, prioritize Rhyme's farm, and it just allows Beezer to carry them through the latter portions of the game. And we'll see if it does work out again, yet again, in this matchup top lane. Beezer just trading hits here with Watson's Water. Watson's does have this Omni Slash available. Knows that he can't really use it with the Doppelganger. It's going to be very, very hard for him to find a solo kill onto the PL.
Yeah, if he uses Omni Slash, PL just double walk, and that's a wasted cooldown, essentially. And this is why they've rotated the PL up here, because Juggernaut can't actually stand there 1v1 versus the Juggernaut like he could versus the Bristleback. So he's going to probably have to transition into a jungle now, unless he gets some help up here to help pressure the PL to either be scared of a gank or to, you know, kill him.
I mean, look at this. This is a fantastic player from Toto, just moving the familiars around. We'll find the stun onto Welt. The song's going to be there to set it up just to move Rhyme in for the kill. They'll find Ishigo, and now they'll look to just chase down Welt. The slow's there from the lightning. There's backup as the ice shards come through. Welt gets the ult up, but it will cancel straight away from the stun from Lesh. Now they're trying to turn it. Sula going in with the snowball. There's going to be a buyback from Ishigo, who does have the RP available. Blade Fury from Watson's Water will bring down the Bristleback. The question is, do they find anything more with the buyback from Ishigo? They're going to try and chase down Toto, but he's got the resummon here, but the familiars drops them down. Sula moving forward, has the ice shards and the snowball in a few seconds. Toto's going for the TP out, will get it. Rhyme trying to fight this, and look at this with the lightning storm. The bounce is going to be there with the Omni Slash, bringing Rhyme low, but he's going to find two. It's a double kill for Rhyme, but he loses it to Ishigo and Watson's Water as they find the less kill in return. And the buyback at the end of the day does work out for Ishigo as they find something, but nonetheless, it is still Monkeys in the favorable position this game.
Yeah, definitely. The Magnus did buy back there, and he managed to just about get back into the backside of the team fight and managed to get the RP off from Rhyme just to secure the kill, even though Rhyme did pick up a double kill. But Magnus did pick up a healthy amount of gold there, but still, you can see there why they're struggling. Watson's Water was looking for a target for his Omni Slash for quite a while. He had a spin-off cooldown twice, actually, for his Omni Slash. So it's looking rough, I'd say, at the best for Zenix at the moment.
I mean, the catch-up potential is there now. Of course, Watson's Water, you know, he's going around the jungle with the Empower, which has got a couple of points in. So his farm game is going to increase, and he is, in fact, ahead of Beezer at this moment in time. A bit of pressure coming in from Rhymer on the top lane. I mean, can they kind of punish this? Whelp is there. Rhyme, he's ready to go incredibly aggressive. Moving in. Now we'll back up. Using the Pulse Nova here. Watson's Water just blade-curing it off. And Rhyme, he just wants to go fully in. Won't find the stun, just holds onto it for the time being, but forcing back the Jug and the CM. Toodle actually wants to go in here onto Cook. He's on his own though, and the Familiars are there, and they might just turn this one around. Moving in with the Riptide, the net as well, the Grave Chill will connect, and Soodle's just going to try and walk this one off. He hasn't got any backup, Soul Assumption flies through, finds the Walrus Punch, but he's going to go down, and Monkeys taking themselves a free kill there in the mid lane.
Yeah, meanwhile that was happening, Techie was actually on the bot lane with the Magnus taking the tier 1 bot, so it just opened up the jungle a little bit for Zenix to maybe invade and get some deep wards in, so that the Monkey doesn't quite have the jungle fully safe. So we're going to have to see what they do with that, if they can do anything with that, rather.
Top lane, Ishigo, RP in 6 seconds, Omni Slash also available. Powered up, if they can find something big here, but Rhyme, he's finished off the yields. Actually going to try and fight himself, but the Blade Fury is there in time. They find the RP onto 2, very, very nice. Rhyme and Toto caught out. They've got the skewer onto 3 as well. They've found the kill onto Rhyme. Mute moving in with the suicide. Will find Toto on the Visage. Now they're going to try and chase for more. Well, with the Frostbite to Corey. Toto coming in with the Wolf Snowball. They'll find Corey as well. 3 heroes die. They lose CM. A fantastic fight for Zenix as they clear off 3 of the heroes, finding 2 of the cores of Monkey. And at the end of the day, that was potentially just Rhyme getting a bit too aggressive there with the Yules, trying to set something up for the team, but just maybe not aware that the RP was available. And fantastic initiation there from Ishigo. I mean, as you said, I know the meme is that he misses them, but he couldn't have hit that one any better.
No, that was a perfect RP, perfect team fight really coming up for Zenix here. But we see the song coming in.
Indeed, this could set up Soothless Demise. No way he's getting out of that one. And Monkey do pick up yet another kill on Tusk in that mid lane.
But that fight on top was all due to Rhyme's sort of, he overestimated how much how tanky he was, and he eventually just got punished. Him and Corey just got punished completely for underestimating the amount of damage.
Oh, poor old CM. Not a lot Welp's going to be able to do is Rhyme. Takes a kill, of course. Well, one of Rhyme's former teammates back in the days of Dwayne, the John Roxon. And Rhyme now turning against his own kind. 18 to 10 at the moment. Monkey's still with the edge. But as we can see, that last fight kind of swinging it around a little bit. It's only a 5k lead here for Monkey. And as I was saying earlier, this game's certainly going better for Zenix than game one did at this point, 19 minutes in.
Yeah, it was just good. That fight was a glimpse of what Zenix could do if they managed to get the correct team fight. They just need to make sure that they can get these those sort of team fights again. I don't think they was even all there at that time. Oh, no, they was. Yeah, it was a 5v5 team fight, I think. So, yeah, it just shows you what Zenix can actually pull out. But it just relies on the ults being hit from Ishigo, really. That's the important crux in the Zenix team plan.
Yeah, absolutely. It's all going to be down to this Magda play. And as we've seen so far, I think, you know, they can rightfully rely on this because 4 kills, and he died the 2 times and does have 2 assists as well. Ishigo's performance has been very, very nice. And to have both the Blink 4 staff, 1300 gold as well at this point, just before the 20-minute mark, it's not bad farm at all on a Magnus that, you've got to remember, did lane up against a Rhyme Leshrac. And oh, hang on, Techies was out of the mines. It looks like it might have just been. Finds himself a solo kill on the PL with, I believe, those remote mines he was stacking up there earlier. So, I mean, that's fantastic for the side of Zenix. If they're killing PL like that, it's going to, 40 seconds off the map, 40 seconds of farm time gone. And especially when he's competing against a Jug with Empower, he's going to fall behind very quickly if he dies a few more times like that.
Yeah, he could really be in trouble if he keeps getting caught off like that.
Well, he's talking about getting caught out. Unfortunately for Welp, we saw it just happen there, close to the base. It'll happen again. This time, can Zenix turn it? They're moving in. The RP is there. Blade Fury as well, opting for that rather than the Omni Slash straight up. And Rhyme might just be able to get himself out. No, the Snowball's coming through. There are Familiars there guarding him up. The stuns will hold back Mew and Watson's. It's just going to be Tool trying to chase this down. We'll find the Snowball with the Warriors Punch, but the Bloodstone Deny comes out. Omni Slash not there in time to finish it off. There she go. Trying to chase down Cook. Cook turns it around with a net. Ice Shards, will it block them off? Unfortunately, it will just block themselves off and they won't be able to chase it anymore. CM forcing the Lesh though to use his Bloodstone. Obviously not ideal, not getting the kill, but still it's a good amount of time that he's off the map as well. So Zenix won't be kicking themselves too hard for that.
No, it's also limiting the amount of Bloodstone charges that Leshrac has, because Leshrac spells are very expensive and he needs those Bloodstone charges to stay in fight. You know, he will burn through that mana that he has very quickly. So he needs these Bloodstones just to stay relevant in team fights.
Gonna be interested to see what Watson's picks up here with this Perseverance. I mean, does he go full in for the battle? I mean, he's already got the Empower. I mean, extra cleave, is it necessary, or is it gonna be something like the Lincolns, or, I mean, is this even a refresher game to get those Omni Slashes out?
No, I think it will be a battlefield. I think he might also need it. Or maybe it could be a Lincoln Sphere, as you said. It could be a Lincoln Sphere, but I think it's going to be a battle fury. He needs to get more cleave. You know, more cleave is good cleave. So.
Indeed, all about the cleavage here. 19 for 12 at the moment. 22 minutes in, still the edge. And as we saw, the graphs kind of flattened out after both Rhyme and Bees are dying. Now allowing Zenix to keep up in terms of farming. And Roche still yet to be contested here by either side. So interesting to see who decides that they can go for it first. I mean, with the Jug, we've got a fairly good lineup, but I guess you look over on the side of Monkey, they do have this Bristleback, Corey level 12 at the moment. Vanguard is complete on top of the treads, 1800 gold as well. Let's see how close he gets here. He's coming in. Sewell maybe trying to force him around. He's going to walk past him. Very nicely done. That's a huge amount of damage. We'll start to bottle up. They're following him through here with the snowball. They've got a Warrior's Punch as well. We'll find it. Suicide's used as well just to secure the kill. And they will find Corey there on the top lane.
Yeah, good kills there from the techies. He obviously had it set up. And the ice shards were perfectly placed to make sure that Corey had to walk right next to the remote mines to kill, get the kill onto the Bristleback, which is quite important. Because obviously, if he becomes a frontline beast and, you know, Rhyme's able to do that, ooh. Or mid lane Magnus can miss with his RP.
Unfortunately, Rhyme's going to try and turn it around. Whelp is there to try and help, but the question is how much can he do? Ishko will just be able to skewer himself out, but it looks like Whelp is going to be able to get himself away. Rhyme, it looks like he might have just been too low for to get that Lightning Storm out in time in terms of mana. So Whelp this time going to be lucky to get himself out with the Crystal Maiden. Worth noticing he is running that Midas as well here on the CM.
Yeah, he wants to be able to get some more items in the game. You know, he's been killed a few times now. He wants to get that Glimmer Cape up and running. Obviously, if in case anyone gets lushed on, pop the Glimmer Cape on them, less damage, survive longer.
Yeah, absolutely. If they can keep this Juggernaut alive, he's got the potential to become incredibly, incredibly scary. Some wine top of the Aquila, 1200 gold as well. He's really breaking apart from Beezer's farm game as well. There's about 2000 gold in it, which, I mean, we very rarely see in a lineup when they go against the farming potential of Beezer. So, all in all, incredibly impressive performance coming out from Watson on the Jug.
Yeah, we also generally see, you know, how Beezer normally has to find his own farm. And Ryan, as you said earlier, Ryan does generally get help with stacks in the jungle. That's why we're seeing Ryan sort of skyrocket ahead. But Beezer's sort of having issues. He's having to be wary of techies. You know, he has to be very careful. So maybe this is just limiting him, this techies pick.
Yeah, as you said, I mean, the techies, he's getting kills, but just the fact that the mind games really forcing Monkey to be that little bit careful. Just something else that they've got to worry about. And how is Techies doing in terms of the farm? So he's going to go for the 4-star fear as his first item on top of the Soaring Arcanes. Yeah, I'm just going to have a quick pause here, unfortunately. But I mean, at this moment in time, I've got to be honest, I'm certainly feeling a lot more hopeful for Zenix than I did in Game 1. Yeah. You know, Game 1, it was just a total kind of outclass of performance. Monkey's got themselves ahead, and there was nothing that Zenix could do to come back against it. And that was with the PL. For this game, well, let's see what Zenix can do, and so far, the cores are looking good.
Yeah, it's looking good for Zenix this game. You know, they're still behind on the gold charts, but you know, it's not an insurmountable lead. Yeah, they can definitely get into this game and get ahead. You know, but they might need to open up the map a bit more, get a couple of more towers.
Yeah.
But I think you was on about Roshan earlier. I don't think that's an option for Zenix, obviously because of the Nargarol. So
that's
they're really
going to
struggle. And also, it's a natural choke point for Leshrac as well. So, I don't know. I don't think that's going to be part of a comeback mechanism they have.
Okay. Yeah, I think, yeah, you're right. And we're more likely to just see them just keep control of their own half of the map and continue to get what's from the farm here on this Juggernaut. And yeah, so it's the completed Battle Fury, as you suggested. Has that complete. And, well, that's going to be very scary with the Empower. I mean, one good RP into Omni Slash, it's just going to melt the heroes and Monkey.
Yeah, it will actually absolutely destroy the team fight, and he looks like he's going to be picking up another Blade of Electricity, so maybe he's going towards that Aghanim Scepter build.
Mid lane, he's going to try to go into Corey, but Corey now with the Crimson Guard complete. Going to be a very, very tanky front line at top lane. Rhyme trying to go at it with Watson. Watson a little bit hesitant to use the Omni Slash because Rhyme, of course, does have that Ghost Scepter.
Yeah, he was waiting. Yeah, he was just waiting for the RP to come off to be used, but so Rhyme couldn't use that Ghost Scepter because, of course, he used that Ghost Scepter. Yeah. You know, he's more than likely going to get away. But, yeah, so Rhyme gets away there. I think he could have probably committed to the Omni Slash. Make Rhyme use the Ghost Scepter. and then chase him down with the SMY and Facebooks afterwards and hope for a Sand proc.
Yeah, I mean, they did have Ishigo there as well. Maybe they could have found an RP, but just wanting to play it safer and maybe just a bit aware that, you know, there could be the TP reactions coming through. There may have been a Naga hiding in the trees there, ready with the song. Yeah. They've got to be very careful when they kind of throw themselves against the heroes and monkeys.
Yeah. They can't afford to be given kills over to Rhyme like that. As you said, if TP reactions came in, that would have been awful. Probably would have lost the tier 2 and or Roche. So you're right, they do have to definitely be careful here.
Back in the mid lane, Hellswalt doing on his road to the Glimmer Kit, coming up to 700 gold on top of the cloak. And Rhyme, obviously with the boots of travel, 2.8k gold as well. He's going to find the stun onto Watson's. But thankfully for Watson's, with the amount of stats that he's built up in terms of items, it's a little bit harder for the Lesh to burst him down. Just continue to do what he can on this tech Easter. Try and keep as much control of his half of the map as possible.
Yeah.
I mean, the question is going to be, when do you feel that Monkey will be kind of, you know, strong enough to try and force down tier 2s and move on to the other side of the map? I mean, it looks like they're maybe thinking about doing it at top, but they've just got to be so careful against the lineup that Zenix have when doing this.
I think they're going to wait for the Naga's actually building the mech, so I think they're definitely going to wait for that.
Oh, well, he's going to die potentially here. 4 seconds till Midas. He's going to want to make sure he can try and get that off. Looks like it's going to be okay. Okay, Watson's coming with a healing ward. Rhyme isn't going to go any further in on that one. And that was a good three heroes moving around here on the top lane from the side of Monkey. Ishigo and Super getting a bit of space mid. And we see Mew soaking up the map. Well, the XP here in the bottom lane has found level 12 on the techies. Top lane, Rhyme trying to move in a little bit more aggressively. Watson, he figures himself back out. And well, he's coming in trying to find a Crystal Nova, but they've got to be careful here. Toto and Cook in the back lines here. And Song of the Siren is available. It's going to be very, very hard for Zenix to initiate, even with an RP, unless they catch out that Naga as well. And it looks like they may just have the tier 2, and they will indeed. Rhyme will be able to pick that one up. Of course, worth noting, with Toto having that Solar Crest as well, just making Rhyme that little bit harder to take down.
Yeah, he's sitting at, 1800 HP with the Ghost Scepter and a Yule Scepter. So he's going to be very tough for Zenix to kill, especially if he's getting the Solar Crest put on top of him as well, to have that evasion and armor.
Corey as well, even after the Crimson Guard, he's got 2.5k gold. This Bristol's farm has been very, very good. And, well, Ryan, he's found Ishigo, but Ishigo, Watson's water are there. Beast is turning up to the fight that Watson's trying to move in, has got the Omni Slash, but he doesn't know who to use it on. Both of these heroes can duke it out. Ishigo being forced back by Corey, and it looks like it will be Watson just left on his own, just trading right clicks here with both of them, holding onto the Omni Slash. And, well, now more will converge. Corey's turning his attention toward Watson's, they have the net there as well. Blade Fury's it. Welp is there. Frostbite onto Corey. Watson, he's got the Omni Slash. He's going to use it here to try and go on the Bristleback. He's thinking about it. The RP's there with the Empower and the Cleave as well. Look at the damage. The Song can't save them. And fantastic play there from Zenix just holding off. I mean, we saw Watson wait and wait with that Omni Slash for the perfect opportunity. And that pays off massively, getting two very big kills.
Yeah, and this is why he's bought the Battle Fury. Because during that fight, he didn't actually have the Cleave. So if he didn't have the cleave there, Rhyme might not have died.
Yeah.
So having that battle free to make sure he always has that cleave. So if that RP does come in from back up, arrive from the other side of the map, he's going to be able to, you know, do the job that he needs to do.
Yeah, and Watson's water now just going in, looking for Roshan. And, well, as you said, it's not a nice line to do it against, but when you've got two heroes down, this is the go time. And with the healing ward, it's not going to cost them anything at all. So Watson's will pick that up. He's got a lot of money in the bank as well on top of that blade. 3.6k gold. And now he's over 3,000 ahead of the PL Beza. Beza did opt for a Skadi this game, so we'll see how that works out for him. Obviously buffing him up in terms of all-round stats. 2.1k gold on him, so the Omni Slash might not be enough on its own to kill him. I mean, we've seen already, he kind of just holds it off and doesn't want to use it on the PL anyway because of the Doppelganger. Yeah. And at the same time, if that PL gets caught in an RP, he's probably going to die nonetheless, 2k HP or not.
Yeah, definitely, but it's just making the PL generally tankier, you know, and also it makes it a lot harder to get away from the PL with the charge and obviously the Skadi proc. I don't think he went for the Diffusal Blade this game. No, he didn't go for the Diffusal Blade this game, so he's gone pure fight stats. He wants full stats, it's on the SMY and Skadi, just so he can, you know, fight at any point, really. And we've seen this from the small engage he has. He's very tanky, very hard to take down.
All right, the setup so well. Watson's moving in, he's got the Omni Slash in 7. He's been Glimmer caked up and back themselves away. Tootle, he's doing pretty well now on the Tusk in terms of farm. I mean, he has died 5 times this game. He has found 5 assists though. Now he's sitting on 2.3k gold, so we'll see what he decides to opt for here. I mean, would you imagine he's just going to pick up a Blinker, or is there other options on the table for the Tusk?
Yeah, he'd go Blinker, he could go it's, I know Sudeldorf like his Shadow Blade, but I think okay. Glimmer Cape or Blink are the more likely options at this stage. But I'm surprised he hasn't picked up the Glimmer already if he was, so I have no idea what he's doing. We'll have to wait and see. But I know he does tend to favour the Shadow Blade over any other item, or the Tuskar.
Indeed, Nishiga. Thoughts just making as much as he can from the map he's got. That plate mail picked up, 1400, 1500 gold as well. Mech now completed here from Cook, ready for the next fight, and he is carrying a gem as well. Obviously, with those illusions, pretty much one of the better counters to techies. But still, I mean, the techies pick's been working out in the sense that Monkey, they have managed to push one tier two, but other than that, kind of left the other two tier twos alone. Just being very, very careful about how close they get to mute, and he's working on his Aghanims, and he's certainly going to have it within the next 5 minutes by the looks of it, if it kind of continues at this pace, this game.
Yeah, he's going to get close towards the Ag, so he can use the minefield sign to hide his remote mines to give Monkey the impression that they're safe with the Gem of Truth site up in the Nagasar Siren.
Well, this is interesting as well from Ishiko. He's going for a very, very early upgrade here on the boss. Mm. I mean, just keeping it as a... Oh, is he just... No, okay, then earlier, yeah, he's got it, so he's leveling up the bots here. This is an interesting one, and I'm going to look forward to see how well this pays off for him, because it's quite a heavy investment at this point in the game where potentially he could have been looking to finish up either a Shiva's or an AC.
Yeah, I think this is so he can now blink on, be a rapid response team for the Juggernaut now, so the Juggernaut can be on his own.
So Omni Slash coming through. What, Toto getting low? What's his water trying to do? What he can with the Blade Fury, but Cook's turned up with a mech. They're going to just turn this one around, and he's going to need some kind of backup. He has got the backup of Ishiko. Gets an RP. Very nice. There is, of course, the Aegis here on the jug, but there's five heroes here on the side of Monkey. Ishiko's going to try and get himself out. The Great Shield's been laid down. They'll chase down the Magnus. They'll find him. They'll also get Watson's water as well. Both of the cores dropping on the side of Zenix, and Monkey reacting very, very nice to what was just a little bit of a bad decision there from the side of Zenix.
Yeah, I think that was a bad decision for Ishiko to go in there. He's just upgraded his boots to level 2, and he thought, you know what, I can get there to help Watson. But I think once Watson had used his Omni Slash and his spin, it's a dead jug. There's no way he's getting away from that situation.
Right, he might just find the killing onto Tsul as well. We'll find the stun follow-up, and here we go with the chase down. He's going to look to TP out, but there's no way he's keeping away from the damage offered in by Beezer joining the fight there.
Yeah, Tusk actually picked up the Reaver, so he's maybe looking towards getting a heart. So neither of the items that I thought he was going to get, or none of the items I thought he was going to get. He just probably wants to be that frontline tank, just get up there, get in their face. Hopefully he can get the run to use all his abilities onto the Tusk.
Well, again, I think he's getting caught out here in the Radiant Jungle. Rhymes found him and will pick up the kill. Glimmer Cape isn't going to save him on the AoE damage there of the Lesh. And we're certainly seeing four heroes off the map here for Zenix, and Monkey kind of just taking back full control of this game. And I can imagine we'll see the graph start to shoot back up after those kills do kick in. As Ryan now starting to build back up those Bloodstone charges that he did lose earlier on. Corey finding space in the enemy jungle. 1k gold on top of the completed Pipe and Crimson Guard. And Toto, of course, on this Visage, finding his way towards that Aghanim Scepter. And talking about Aghanim Scepter, how's the techies doing? They still got a good kind of, 1,400 to go.
Yeah. But Juggernaut actually bought the Blade of Alacrity, so I thought he might be going for a Diffuser or an Aghanim. He's actually gone back and he's starting his way towards a Butterfly. So, you know, he's seen the risk of Beezer being able to sit there and just man fight him. So, you know, he's decided that Butterfly was obviously the choice for him. But it means that this Blade of Alacrity isn't going to be used for quite a while. Obviously, the Blade will be used to get rid of the Ghost Scepter on Rhyme. But they've decided that's not
really good. Moving in on Corey, but Rhymes here with the turnaround, has for the double damage, will miss the stun. Watson's water will be able to play Fury back as well. Corey trying to move forward. Pipe and Crimson has been popped. Watson's got the Omni Slash here. Beezer will find the Spirit Lance just forward. Now he's just clearing out the creep wave and can't quite chase down Watson. Hanging around on the sideline. Tsul is there. Welp as well to back them up. And the Shards will trap up Rhyme here, but now he's still going to be able to get himself out. Ishiko will be able to cancel the RP. They're holding on to it. Now Rhyme trying to find Sudal, will find the split up. Sudal needs a lot of help if they want to try and save him. Glimmer Capes comes out, the Ice Shards very nicely blocking off the Lesh. Sudal will be able to live. He'll still talking about Watson. It's again the Blade Fury coming out. Jukes out the stun. Well, finds the frostbite. Ishiko now with the RP. There's some mines here bringing Rhyme into them. He's got a couple laid down with the suicide as well available, but the song's there in time. Rhyme's going to get mech'd up, and I think the Silent Monkey, they want to go for round two. They'll find the stun onto Watson. Watson gets forced back in by the tech as he gets the Omni Slash off. The slash is coming through. Finds the kill up to Cook. That's going to be one down. They do come out with the suicide, but it doesn't matter. They've lost two. Rhyme and Corey, they're going to try and chase down Watson's here. He's trying to Blade Fury himself away, but Rhyme's there with the Yules. They clear out the jug. Four heroes dropping on the side of Zenix, and it's only Ishigo who's able to get himself out of there.
Yeah, it's a good team point coming out for Rhyme, for Monkey there. They was able to sort of delay the fight, you know. They was able to disengage Rhyme when he looked in trouble with the RP, and then they was able to turn the fight. You know, really good team play coming out there from Cook on the Nagasaren, making sure that Rhyme was saved. He managed to get the mech off. Rhyme, obviously, with the Octarine Core, able to survive the fight, and the Bloodstone keeping him in the game as well.
Here we go, the high ground push, and the question is, what do you do to stop this? I mean, the odds are kind of nothing when you've got a jug down for 50 seconds. This could potentially be a set of racks going down. Now, Zenix really don't have the tools to utilize and take this push away from the side of Monkey, and it's going to be the mid set of racks fully going down. You're starting to set up camp, but Monkey are going to be very, very happy with that. We'll look at the graph, and indeed it is starting to break away in terms of their favor quite greatly now, with a 14,000 gold lead coming out, and XP as well coming up to the 14K mark as well. So it's looking a bit rocky and rockier here for Zenix as they are starting to fall behind.
This is what I was worried about at the start of the game, you know. Monkey had the tools, the tools to get themselves into at least the mid game, and that's when their hero, when their composition would start to shine. And Zenix really struggled, you know. They were struggling throughout like the mid game to stay relevant. You know, they're keeping up with farm, but when you're trading farm with heroes like Visage, Naga, Lesh, and Phantom Lancer, it's only going to be a one-way street, and you're eventually going to start falling behind and start losing team fights.
Absolutely, and he's going to be big to turn this one around. Rhyme, he's picked up now the Octarine. You've actually, interestingly enough, a bit of an interesting build from Visa. He opts for the E-Blade here on the PL.
Yeah, he's done this a couple of times during this tournament. It's because PL has quite a lot of, obviously, agility. You know, his stat gain's quite good. So you can see it's what it's going to be used for this. You know, it's a bit of extra burst. It's like a double lance, essentially. And also, it can save him from the Juggernaut, because the Juggernaut still does not have that Diffusal Blade.
Indeed, he's still way off that one. Checking out the Roche Pit. He's going to be up in about a minute or so. Is coming through, just scouting out, seeing what the action is from Zenix. And I know that they're out at the base at the moment, and that might be the go time for Rhyme just to move in and see if he can find a kill. He knows that Sudal's potential on his own, so he's not scared to just go up straight away with the Diabolic Edict, get some damage done onto that tier 3, and he realizes there's not really much of a reaction coming through, so he just stands there proud on the high ground, continuing to hammer away at the tower. Now comes in a snowball, but Rhyme, he's just so damn tanky with the Octarine. 10 charges in the Bloodstone, the completed Shiva's Guard. I don't know how you kill this Lesh. He's going to move in for the kill onto Zulu, trying to move forward, and Zulu will get forced back by Mute. Rhyme just chasing down through the jungle. Oh, is he going to go for it? No, he's going to keep himself out. Good looks for Mute. Mute will pop the suicide. Watson has got the Omni Slash. Then we'll come through onto the Rhyme with the Aurora's Punch as well, but now, Song of the Siren coming through. They look to re-engage. They'll get Rhyme out of here. Corey wants to re-engage potentially the front line, and he'll move forward. There's your RP. Does catch through the Omni Slash as well. They found the kill onto Rhyme. If they can get Corey as well, it's going to be massive. The mines! They set it up with a skewer. They find both Corey and both Rhyme. Beezer's left on his own to run away with Cook and Toto backing off. And a very nice bit of play there from the players of Zenix.
Yeah, very good high ground defense there. We actually see Ishiko TPing straight back onto Watson there to give him the cleave against him and carry on farming. But no, very good high ground defense. They knew what they needed to do. They know they need to wait for the Son of the Siren now, because they will be used to this game.
And Watson's just 1v1 in each other. It's going to come out on top for Beezer, really, with the amount of items he's got. It's actually doppelgangering in. Wants to maybe fight this, but Ishiko is about. Does have Skewer available. Cook's turned up as well with the net. Ishiko can't quite find the blink range to get that one. And they will back themselves up. But yeah, two heroes down on the side of Monkey still. And this is exactly what Zenix needs, to have that time and space to get the Jugs farm back up and work his way, as you said, towards potentially that Diffusal Blade.
Yeah, he needs to. I don't know if it's too late for that now, because he needs other items now. He needs something like a Basher or something like that. Mega Basher would help lock the Lesh down, and something else maybe need to pick up the Diffusal Blade. But it's getting late in the game for Jugs' relevancy. But they're more and more reliant on Ishigo to get these massive RPs as the game goes on.
This is very nice here for Zenix. If they get away with it, and what with the damage from Watson's, they'll almost certainly do so. Han has moved in now with the Yules onto the Magnus. Watson's Water finds the Roshan, and he will be able to pick up the Aegis. He's going to be ready to fight. Ishiko getting caught out, will be able to secure it right back here. But Ishiko looks like it will still go down. They'll lose the Magnus here. Watson's Water being trapped up by the net. Well, moving himself up to the high ground, and Watson's Water now in the retreat as well. Pipes being popped, trying to hold them back here, but Ryan now catching out the CM with the Yules. Won't find the stun follow, but it doesn't matter at all. They'll still kill well, and now they're moving in for more. Mew hiding in the tree line here. They have managed to get Jug all the way back to base. They want to find Mew. Looks like Mew will be able to keep himself out of the business, but Soodle won't. Soodle's going to go down. It's a double kill here for Toto. Now three heroes are down. Buybacks are available, and Ishigo's going to pop his straight away, realizing they can't afford to lose a second set of racks. Let's see if the plays are going to happen here. Moving forward, ultimates are available. Looking for that opening. Maybe they can find it here on that top lane. Maybe just frontlining it here onto the tower. Soodle's trying to kick the action off. There's going to be a blink that's now been purchased by Ryan as he backs himself off. Buyback now from Welp as well on the CM. And Watson's Ward is just going to try and chase this one down. Moving in onto Beezer. He's got this BKB here as well, which was his item of choice. He's going to continue to chase it. They really want to try and find something here, Zenix. They want to look for monkeys, maybe deciding to back off, and well, Song's just going to come out. Monkey realize they're being chased, and they don't want to give anything away here to the aggressiveness of Zenix.
Yeah, BKB really important here for Juggernaut. So it means if Magnix sets the RP off, he can just pop the BKB, run in, and make sure that he can't be interrupted during any sort of damage phase. And also, you know, helps him versus the Lesh, so he can man fight the Lesh after it spins down.
And Basher is going to be the item of choice here from Pierre. So, I mean, Beezer is certainly becoming very, very scary. We saw for a position, kind of a portion of the game, where Jug did have the edge, but Jug in the middle lane won't get caught out here by the split left, does manage to blade it, pure himself away. But yeah, now Beezer's closed that gap, and he's looking just as scary, if not scarier, really, than the Jug carry that Zenix have got this game.
Yeah, Pierre obviously being an illusion-based carry, you know, he utilizes the farm a lot better than a Juggernaut would, unfortunately. So as the game goes on, he's going to get more and more scarier, and Jug's going to get less and less scarier.
Looks like Welp here now with the Midas Gold, trying to work his way towards the BKB. He has the Ochre Club picked up, coming up to 1,500 gold as well. So good few minutes' time, he will have that recipe. And may have an easier time in these fights, and an easier time really getting off a full-length ultimate mid lane. I'll find something in the one, the tier one at least. Potential wraparound being looked for here by Rhyme as he's managed to found himself an invis rune. Soodle, he's kind of been left alone here. Split-up's going to connect and Rhyme's going to start to move in. Soodle will hold himself in the ball for a little bit. Maybe try and move people in here. Ishiko trying to find the positioning and it will. He'll get the RP. One to one, it's just onto Rhyme, but Rhyme just being buffed up. Gone in with the Omni Slash, but there's so many things that it's going to connect on. Just not doing enough. Corey's going to chase down Ishiko. Watson's Water in the middle of it all trying to fight it, but they've got the Crimson Guard that's being popped. Snowball will fly through, but Watson's Water is just getting taken down. He's got the Aegis. He's going to be back for round two. Julian caught up by the split up. There's a mega kill streak here for the Visage. Watson's Water trying to fight, but the Familiar Stun's controlling him. Mega kill streak for Toto. And that is the Juggernaut down for 90 seconds with no buyback. Tusk is off the map as well, and Ryan's moving forward. He's not done. Wants to find Ishiko. Should be able to find this one. The skewer's going to be there. Has he got any kind of regen? Oh, he doesn't need it. 5 HP just survives. But the question is, what is Ishiko going to be able to do against this push on his own with Welp? I think the answer to King David is not a lot.
No, I don't think there's anything here they can do in the game. I think this is almost coming towards the end of the game now. Should be the final push of the game. There's no RP. There's CM's not going to be able to do anything, unfortunately. And we see Ishiko almost die here. Jug's down for 52. You know, I'd imagine this is game.
Yeah. I mean, for Xenix, they held on a lot better in this game than in game one. But at the end of the day, the power of Monkeys was too much. And this is going to be it. And, of course, congratulations to Monkey, who take the series and take the final. There we have our LAN winners this time at I-55 in the Emerge Cup. Also shout out to Sennheiser as well for sponsoring this one. And Monkeys will win themselves £2,500 here for first place. And that's not a bad bit of cash for a weekend of Dota here in the UK.
No, it's a good amount of prize pool. And of course, Team Xenix get £1,000 for second place. So also a good amount of money for them. And they played well throughout this tournament, obviously going down to the lower bracket from Team Monkey, I believe, in the upper bracket semis. The upper bracket semis, and then fighting their way, beating the number one seed, getting back into the grand final, and putting on a good show for us. Unfortunately, today they didn't manage to take a game off Monkey, which they had done previously. I believe they're the only team in the tournament that's actually taken a game off of Monkeys. So, you know, there was the opportunity there for Zenix
there
to come through.
There really was.
But unfortunately, it didn't quite work out well for them today. So, yeah, well played to both teams. Zenix did well. They did well to stay in this game as long as they did, because they do have sort of a mid-game-centric lineup. And so you saw the dominance of Monkeys coming out with their draft afterwards.
Yeah, it was really fun watching the Jug and with the Battle Fury build. Not something that we see every day. Yeah. And how well it did kind of work for the opportunities where they did find those RPs into Omni Slashes. But it, as you said, it got to that point where, I mean, Corey on the Bristleback, he did die quite a lot at the start, died 8 times, but he came back absolutely perfectly with the Crimson Guard complete, the pipe, and at the end of the day, he had the AC as well. Yeah. Certainly pretty much making the Jug combo redundant.
Yeah, he was an absolute raid boss, really. You know, he was providing utility to the team. He's given armor to his team, minus armor to the enemy team, pipe for the team, and also the minus damage coming out of the Crimson Guard. Really helped just his team overall just to survive in team fights. You know, that plus, well, Crimson Guard and everything helping during the Jug ultimate, so they're taking less damage, and also the AC.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And what a performance, and congratulations to Monkey for winning. The Beezer and Rhyme stack do it again. And now we're going to head over to Matt. It's bye from myself, OD Pixel, and of course Dave. I hope you enjoyed the casting. And we'll head over to Matt on the stage, who I believe is going to have a few words with the players from that final.
Congratulations to both teams for making it to our final here at the Esports Arena at Insomnia 55. Commiserations to you, ZenX. A great fight. Good to see two teams having a rematch again as well. I think everybody enjoys a good rematch in our tournaments. So congratulations for making it this far. You are runners-up. Congratulations on winning our £1,000 prize for runners-up, courtesy of Emerge. A round of applause, please, for ZenX. And congratulations to Monkey, our winners. Rhyme, let's have a quick chat with you. Was that a final that was pretty much won and lost at the picking stages for both maps?
For the first game, I would say that it wasn't so much just the picks, it was just everything we wanted to do kind of worked out, and then we had a window to execute, and then we did it in the first 30 minutes, and then they couldn't defend. So, second game, they went for something pretty gimmicky, toss techies. If it doesn't work out really strong in the first 15 minutes or so, it's just they're going to lose, but they're going to lose over a period of time. It's a matter of how long it's going to take.
So you were confident throughout that second map. It was going to be your game. You just needed to see it through, not overstretch, not make any mistakes.
Yeah, it was more so that we just had to be patient, take everything slow, go tower by tower, then eventually we would just get traction and then go forward.
And when Shrek wasn't banned, how did you feel knowing that you could play him?
Sorry for everyone else in the game.
That's a very confident answer. You're pretty sure if you've got Shrek, it's a done deal.
It's Leshrek, and yeah, it's just a really good hero, and just useful at all points in the game. So,
well, congratulations, guys! You've won our tournament. You've won £2,500, courtesy of Emerge. Here is your prize.